Start recording. And let me go ahead and banter for a second while I update.
Do you have an intro prepared at all, or?
I have a little theme music.
Theme music for this podcast.
Funny.
The Rusted Razor or something.
The Rusty Razor.
Rusty Razor podcast. Amateur hour. Are you recording right now?
Oh, hey, check it out. Yeah, it's recording right now. Oh. Yeah, Reverend Dom's in the chat room.
Nice. Our one listener, one supporter.
All right, let me copy that.
That's the internet has made it easy for us to put stuff out there, but it's also made the listener's attention span very, very short.
Right.
Here on the Amateur Hour podcast, where we are updating our Facebook status. Thrilling, thrilling radio.
Dog, dog, dog. All right, let me bring Winamp back up. Oops. Get rid of all this.
Apparently there's an intro song. I'm just as excited as anyone else to see what it is.
And there. And delete. Goodbye. Thank you.
No Kid Rock?
Ah, fuck. I brought up the... clicked the wrong link. All right, here we go.
Look at you. You was popping all that good shit a second ago. Then you got kicked in your chest.
The mics are still live. I don't give a shit. This is test hour. 1-2, 1-2.
Test podcast. Or, like I said, amateur hour.
And my phone's dying from all that streaming I was doing without it plugged in earlier.
Look at you.
No, no, you don't repeat. I turned repeat off. Punk-ass fucking Winamp. If you're listening live, it is 10 p.m. Pacific time, Friday, October the 14th, 2011. If you're listening via the podcast, well, it's later than that. My name is Designated Dave.
Primo.
This is the Rusty Razor Podcast. I fucking love that name.
I don't even understand it.
It's you know, you put wrist cutters, and I thought of Rusty Razors.
Have you seen that movie?
No.
No? Good.
I didn't know it was a movie. I thought you were just being you. like describing a song or something. Like, you know, just being your normal Primo self.
That's a good song title, too, but the flick is pretty awesome.
Yeah. It's been 4.5 months since we've rambled. And I figured it was time for us to ramble again. And my phone's still streaming. All of a sudden, I'm hearing my voice coming from my phone. I'm like, hello? So let me go ahead and shut this down.
We are entertaining no one.
All right, there we go. All right. Yeah, there's quite a bit to ramble about, and even some things that I want to ask you directly.
Ah.
Based on some things that I've been reading in news and shit like that.
Great.
So
usually pretty opinionated.
Yeah. So we're not going to go through all these. I just highlighted some shit. that was just one day of news stories. And I'm like, yeah. If anything happens like tomorrow, which was yesterday, I'm like, I'm gonna have to edit some of these out. And I actually came up with a couple today that we're gonna replace some of these with.
Well, this could be interesting then, because I'm completely clueless about all of this news stuff. I don't pay attention to any of it. So.
And most of it's actually local. Like, on the fucking, you know, the Yahoo News site. Yes, I use Yahoo News. ABC News. Death to them. Actually, they're joined up now. Yahoo News and ABC News are running the same fucking news feeds.
Isn't Fox the one that gets all the hate?
Well, Fox gets all the hate because they're fucking conservative biased.
Ah.
And that's why I said the other day... on my random fact that two presidents died on the exact same day, which was John Adams and Thomas Jefferson. They both died July 4th, 1826. And how it would be ironic today if two presidents died on the same day. Because, you know, take, okay, and here was my example. Take Jimmy Carter And
is he still alive?
Yes. I used live presidents.
Okay.
Take Jimmy Carter and George H.W. Bush. Okay. The, you know, Jimmy Carter's Democrat, Bush is obviously Republican. Okay. I was saying that on Fox, they would, you know, be sad and cover the triumphs of the George H.W. Bush thing. And over on MSNBC, they'd cover Jimmy Carter in the same way. And when it came time to mention the other president, they'd each just fucking, hey, this is what was wrong with their administration, and then go back to being sorry for the other president. So, that's how that works. You know what? There is a chat room. There's a little chat room. Primo's mic, but Primo needs to back off the mic a little. Actually, let me turn his mic gain down a little bit. Yeah, I wasn't able to adjust, because the mics actually, you know, come through fairly differently. Like, mine's right past 12 o'clock, and yours was actually all the way over for whatever reason. I don't know.
All right, well, testing, let me know how it is now.
All right. So, one of the first news stories, and here's the the headline, Sony freezes gaming accounts after hacking attack. I didn't even copy any of the news story, because as both of us being Sony, former Sony grunts ourselves.
Hold on.
Okay. I was a former Sony grunt.
I was a Remedy Staffing Services grunt.
Do you really think, I mean, look at all the attacks that happened while we were both at Sony still. The fucking, the PSN hacking, the, you know, the movie hacking, the Sony Grease hacking. Someone really pissed off Sony that much?
It's pathetic that I worked there, and the only one I know about is the first one, the PSN attack. Did you say Grease?
Grease, yeah. Sony Grease, their website, Sony Music, Sony Canada, actually, you know, all sorts of fucking hacking attacks.
Sony Canada.
Yeah. Sony Canada, eh? Let me check something real quick. Okay. Because
Canadians aren't weird enough. There's fucking Japanese people in Canada.
Okay, Primo's good. Good. You're good now. Methamphetamines found inside cans of food.
Awesome.
Oh, this screams San Diego.
Wait, this was in San Diego?
Hell yeah, it was at the fucking Otay Porter Crossing.
Okay, USA.
In, wait a minute, like, contaminated food? Or they took out the food and hid methamphetamine in there?
Have you ever shopped at Smart and Final?
It's been years.
You know the big fucking cans of, like, nacho cheese and jalapenos?
Okay.
They opened up the cans and fucking put the methamphetamine right in the middle. And they tried to cross the border with it.
Okay, USA.
That is Mexican ingenuity going down right there.
Yeah. Here's the entire story. San Diego, obviously. A 27-year-old citizen living in Tijuana has been arrested after trying to smuggle illegal drugs inside cans of jalapenos and cheese sauce. The bust happened at the Otay Mesa Port of Entry. CBP, Customs Border Protection, found something suspicious about the cans in the woman's car.
Holy shit.
It was a woman trying to transport methamphetamine in fucking 7 pounds of methamphetamine in cans of food.
Okay, what was suspicious, though? That doesn't even say.
Probably the fact that she had her, you know, hands on the steering wheel. Or, like, you know, most of the time, if you cross, like, if you look white, and it says it's a citizen living in TJ.
You look white as opposed to being white?
Well, if you, no, like, because most people use the San Ysidro border crossing.
Right.
Most white people, if they see a white person by themselves, and this has happened to me more than once when I lived in TJ. If they see a white person by themselves more than, you know, crossing at Otay, they'll probably send you to secondary. In fact, that actually happened on my first day of work at Sony. So, you know. Hey, for all you...
I'm trying to wrap my head around that.
For all you people out there, don't try and transport methamphetamines in cans of food.
Is this chicken what I have, or is this fish?
If you do, don't look suspicious.
I know it's tuna, but it says chicken by the sea.
I got so many more of those. I spent all last night downloading sound effects. Man who fell downtown in San Diego was suspected of hit and run. Did you hear about this?
Did not.
There was a guy who was at the Occupy San Diego fucking...
What the fuck is that shit anyway? I don't even know what that is.
Well,
it sounds like a bunch of rich people crying.
Actually, it's a whole bunch of poor people crying at the rich. The original one was Occupy Wall Street. It's all about these fucking bankers and, you know, investors. The, it basically goes, you know the saying, the top 1% of the population controls 99% of the wealth.
Yeah, that sounds like something in a Noam Chomsky book.
Well, all these people are getting mad that, these banks and these fucking investment firms and shit like that are squandering away the money, while people like you and me, well, are jobless. And,
why now? I mean, this is...
People want something to whine about.
Yeah, because I remember hearing about that quote. I mean, I remember learning about shit like that in high school, in like the senior year of high school.
Fuck you, asshole.
No one ever made a big deal out of it then, but now, what are they doing? I mean, they're
protesting. They're like, trying to make a stand, like by going old school and fucking, hell no, we won't go. In fact, at midnight last night, San Diego police ordered the vacation of all the tents that were around downtown.
Tents? What the fuck?
People were sleeping in tents.
People are sleeping in tents on where?
I don't know, like Union, Front Street.
The steps of the mayor's office or something? That's
the only difference between these people and the fucking homeless people is they have tents.
No, the difference is these assholes that are fucking protesting probably tweeting about it on their fucking cell phones while they complain about rich people.
Cut that bitch off!
But here's part of the story, and I highlighted a couple things, because this guy, fucking, they're investigating this as a suicide. Okay. He fell off an 8-story fucking building and landed, like near a whole bunch of these protesters. So they thought that he offed himself in fucking protest. But apparently this guy had nothing to do with the protest.
This is America. People don't do shit like that.
No. Listen to this guy. Kyle Pearson of San Diego was charged with vehicular manslaughter while intoxicated and fleeing the scene of a crash on the June 7th. And this story came out October the 12th. June 7th death of Jaime Obeso.
Jamie Obese?
53, he was supervising road work when he was struck and killed on Interstate 8 near the Sunbeam Rest Area, 6 miles west of El Centro. Which definitely means that this guy,
okay, USA,
was Mexican.
Claro.
Pearson allegedly plowed through the safety cones, struck Obeso, continued through the rest stop, and then flipped his own pickup. Now, I highlighted a line. He was believed to have been under the influence of marijuana at the time.
No. No, no. Marijuana doesn't do that to you. All right, that's crazy. That's alcohol actions.
Well, he was supposed to be in court on Tuesday, but he no-showed, and then he offed himself on Wednesday.
Sweet.
Now, here's some... I wrote this. I jotted this down. This was a comment on the story about the methamphetamine. Right.
Internet comments?
Right.
Oh, this is bound to be full of wisdom.
True story. And that's how it starts. True story.
So we can safely assume that it's not a true story.
Right. We can, but it is pretty funny. Yesterday, I drove into Mexico and visited as many Mexican government agencies as time permitted. To each, I informed them I was an USA citizen and planning to move to Mexico illegally. I informed them I needed to apply for food stamps and free rent money. My girlfriend was pregnant, and therefore we needed child allowance. I also informed them I would expect that they pay my unborn son's university tuition. Besides all the crazy looks that I received from these individuals, I was informed that these things don't come for free. They stated that I had to get a letter from the employer offering me employment. The letter needed to state that he had offered me the position after failing to fill the position with a Mexican citizen, and I would need to apply for a working visa. I was unable to get anything free there. Why do Mexican illegals expect everything for free here? Well, did you hear that they're actually...
I'm speechless, kind of.
Did you actually hear that it's been kind of official that we're helping undocumented... immigrants, and let's just call them what we call them here in San Diego, illegal fucking Mexicans.
That's policy, right?
We're offering them, we're covering their fucking tuition if they go to a CSU or a UC school.
Even though they're illegal.
Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, hardworking Americans like you and me our fucking, oh yeah, by the way, this podcast is sponsored by the State of California Employment Development Department because they're the people who are paying our bills right now.
Hardworking Americans like you and I. Oh my God. Okay, so seriously, what is the argument against that?
The argument against the, like, paying for
illegals' education.
Well, that they're here undocumented as it is.
Yeah, but if we're not going to put the effort into regulating that, then we might as well.
Oh, exactly. Pay for them, exactly, right? And it's more people fucking finding something to bitch about. I say we go the machete route. Electrified border fence. Zzz.
Electrified border fence. Yes.
Senator McLaughlin. Now, here's one you and me will get more, you know, more because we live in San Diego County, although you probably don't know where Vista is.
I don't know shit.
Okay, Vista is where we went to see Machete.
Okay, a lot of white people out there.
A popular Vista taco shop was burglarized before a suspicious fire gutted it early Wednesday. Okay, the cash register to this Vista taco shop was found in Oceanside. Oceanside from Vista is about 30 miles. In like 25, 30 miles.
That sounds like white people things.
But here's the two lines I highlighted. Manuel Garduno, 14, stopped a moment with some friends at the yellow caution tape outside to stare at the wreckage. Here's the quote. A lot of people came here after school. They had like the crunchiest nachos and the sour cream they add to it. There's something about it. That fucking quote made the newspaper.
What the fuck?
They people? Had like the crunchiest nachos.
This is exactly why we're paying for their fucking education, because they're here, they're going to be here, and we're not willing to kick them out, so we might as well educate them, right?
Workers at businesses along the street said they often stop by for tacos and tostadas. Now, here's one. This is the Mexican fucking equivalent of people living in the Midwest, white people, except for the white people in the Midwest are just idiots. He said the family plans to rebuild it so that one day their children can run it for many more.
This is our dirt. This is our plot of land. Don't you touch our fucking land.
My granddaddy fucking, my granddaddy built this land. I'm going to have it. My children are going to run it too. We going to rebuild after that tornado. Grade schoolers to get iPads instead of textbooks. I read that and I get pissed.
Why?
What if I wanted a fucking iPad when I went to school? You know how heavy my fucking backpack was?
You didn't get a laptop?
What? No, I'm not that old. I'm not, well, I'm old, a lot older than you think.
Well, you're only a few years older than I am, aren't you?
But you got a laptop at school?
Yeah, it was.
Fuck you and Hoover High. You got a laptop at Hoover?
Yeah.
Fuck you.
It wasn't ours to keep, but we would get to school and we would check one out, you know, and we'd get to carry it around for homework and whatnot.
Nope.
If it's any consolation, they were shitty, shitty Macs.
You know how heavy my fucking backpack was? like seriously, it's like, I can totally understand, and you're going to fucking crack up at this. I can totally understand what a woman with big tits goes through, kind of on the reverse side. You know how they have to have those fucking reinforced bras to, you know, because their back hurts or...
How do you know?
Because I know a lot of women with fucking big tits. But I'm saying in reverse, because my backpack, with all that weight, was hanging off my back.
So you had tits on your back, basically.
I had back tits. I had fucking, you know,
That could be a really rare sexist comment. That could be interpreted really badly.
Take it as you will. You know, fucking, you know the tagline that I put for this show? It's two mics, two minds, no limits.
And a whole lot of racism and offensive things.
Now, here's the thing. You got it at Hoover, right? Listen to this. Educators in the Encinitas Union School District, Encinitas is in San Diego County, have started rolling out a plan that could eventually have all students in grades 3 through 6 have iPads instead of textbooks.
Which is fine if you block all the apps that are entertainment. You know,
okay, third graders are generally 8 and 9-year-olds. Those things are going to break.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. But, shit, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, that's why I said, you know, it's one thing that you got it at Hoover, you were in high school. They're going to give it, they're going to let fucking kids 8 and 9 years old, you know.
Well, you have kids younger and younger handling cell phones, and You got to realize it's a different.
I gave Brielle a BlackBerry, and that's because I didn't use it anymore, and she liked high-tech equipment because she smacked her mom in the face with a wireless mouse.
It's a different generation. You know, we have kids growing up with technology, whereas we were discovering it, you know, as we grew up. But it's a regular part of life for them now. I think they might. I don't know. I don't even have any fucking kids, so I wouldn't know. But I suspect.
I'm right there with you.
I suspect.
I can joke about it sometimes, all right?
That's good. But yeah, I suspect that it might be all right for kids that young. But my main concern is block all the entertainment apps. Make sure they're using it for school purposes.
Here's one that screams, you idiot, you had every fucking opportunity not to get caught or shut your mouth. Border Patrol agent convicted in drug trafficking. This was in Phoenix. A U.S. Border Patrol agent caught with more than 700 pounds of marijuana.
Over 9,000.
Inside his truck was convicted in Arizona on Wednesday of drug trafficking charges. Michael Atondo, 34, was arrested in April while on duty near the U.S.-Mexico border with 44 marijuana bundles stacked neatly inside his marked Border Patrol vehicle. Yeah, faces up to 40 years in prison on each offense and a fine of up to $2 million. Prosecutor said Atondo was supposed to have been on patrol in Welton, where the fuck that is. Oh, a substation in the western part of the state. On April 4th, but set off a sensor miles away in a remote stretch of desert near San Luis, Arizona. U.S. Homeland Security reports that 129 agents were arrested on corruption charges between 2003 and 2009.
That's not bad. 129.
Right, that's not bad, fucking, which means this idiot fucking, he should have known better. Like, as in ways not to get caught, not to set off sensors, fucking, you know, dealing with the right types of Mexicans.
It could be a movie there.
Yeah. U.S. death toll from cantaloupes rises to 23.
What the fuck?
All these are from a Colorado-based company, which makes me write that next line, Mexican cantaloupes aren't killing anyone. So when it comes to most things you want to buy for you and your family, buy American, except for produce, buy Mexican.
Dude, Mexican produce is way better.
Hell yeah, it is.
They use less or no pesticides and none of that stuff.
They had this fruit stand for many years. They actually fucking took it down now. Many years on Main Street, about 4 miles up. It's between here and James's house. And they had the fucking best fruit there. And tomato. Oh, my God. Oh. 80% of U.S. boys use condoms the first time. Before we get into this story, did you?
Yes, of course. It should be 100%.
It should be 100%. Now,
Well, now, you said it's a different generation when you were going to school. Did they hand out condoms when you were?
No, I got all mine from my mom.
Yeah, no, they...
My mom was a horrible parent, and nothing else can be said about that otherwise.
Well, she gave you a condom.
But she gave me condoms. She did some things right.
Yeah. One of probably few things that she did right.
Like, she gave me condoms. Like, and here's the thing, and I was thinking about this the other day. Most of the time, and I'd say a good 90 to 95% of anything that can either be asked of me or I get something, I will almost always say please and thank you. Hold on just a second. Come in! Hey, it's Joe. A little bit busy right now. We're actually podcasting live. That's what I'm sitting there. I got my headphones like clink, clink. I'm like, uh-oh, fuck, are we too loud? I'm like, we shouldn't be. We've broadcasted louder than this. You want to say hi, Joe?
What up?
The microphone won't pick you up from there.
You're
saying hi to Reverend Dom and all the many one listener we have.
All right, one listener. You're the bomb. We love you. Keep it real.
Yeah, this is actually, like, we're streaming it now, and I'm actually recording it to put it up as a podcast. But if you're still awake when we're done, I'll get at you.
I will be.
Okay.
So, yeah. Just
Word?
Hit me up on G-talk.
Okay. Cool. And that was Obi-Wan Joe Kobe.
The neighbor man checking in.
See, this is why I like doing live shit. All right.
Wait, you mentioned something about being able to broadcast video as well?
Yes.
We're doing that at some point?
We're going to do that at some point. That's okay. One of the reasons I tested fucking a video file is to see if we can do that. And I've got webcam, I've got video cam, I got web... why? What's so funny? Go ahead, Primo.
I'm just thinking I need to be high as fuck to do this.
Okay, USA.
with video cam.
Oh.
Because I'm picturing you know, the Joe Rogan podcast.
Right.
Where they have video set up and they... Of course, they smoke before every podcast.
Right.
So I might have to try that in future.
I'm God, and bitch you not.
I don't even want to know where that came from.
It's fucking Reverend X.
Who the fuck is Reverend X?
Cut that bitch off!
Oh, Hobo with a Shotgun?
No. Hobo with a Shotgun. Like, the dude, the black dude who was, I don't know.
Black Shampoo.
Black Shampoo.
What did you say, nigga?
Don't worry, I've got things set up for most situations. Boys' condom use may mean that they are taking more responsibility for contraception, or they are protecting themselves from sexually transmitted diseases, experts say. Or, as one young man said, girls may be drawing the line. Here's the quote. I'm not sure how much of this is guys thinking that they need to use a condom or girls insisting they use a condom, said 17-year-old Olivier Vanasse of Princeton, New Jersey.
Oh, it's going to be bad.
I'd be hesitant to give guys credit for coming up with this on their own.
Fuck you, asshole.
Okay. Now, 30 years ago, girls wouldn't have said, hey, you need to use a condom.
30 years ago, a girl ending up pregnant was a fucking tragedy.
Yeah, they'd actually fucking expel you from school.
Yeah, and you'd lose most of your friends. You'd be looked down upon by society.
Unless you were an absolute fucking stoner and your parents supplied the fucking weed for most of the neighborhood, then you'd keep most of your old friends like my mom and my uncle did.
What, are you saying you ended up pregnant at 18?
No, my mom ended up pregnant at 16.
Ah, gotcha.
With me.
Fuck you, asshole.
Yeah, I would think now after, you know, we have at least probably two generations of where a lot of guys got caught up, you know, having babies and not using protection. I think after, you know, guys were
pulling out doesn't work.
Yeah, I think we're finally getting that. I hope we're finally getting that.
I got that.
Yeah, I got it a long time ago.
Okay, USA.
But yeah, you'd think after a few generations of guys getting caught up by old ladies, you know, we'd get smart, and so hopefully that's what's happening. Whatever this bitch is, she's not giving credit to the guys, but I give credit to the guys because
I don't want my dick to fall off, and I don't, you know, I would venture to guess that between the 1980s and now, there are far, far, far fewer after school fucking programs about teen pregnancy, and I'm guessing that teen pregnancy is probably on the decline.
You know, I don't know for sure, but I'm pretty sure I saw an article about that probably like a few years back. Mm. I remember reading, yeah, about how the statistics have declined.
Yeah. Overall, about 43% of girls and 42% of boys report ever having vaginal intercourse. Guess what? There's about 58% of boys, actually, let's drop that, 56% of boys who are fucking lying to you.
You got to think, too. The other thing that would affect this is kids are getting wise to the whole sex thing a lot younger now. So hopefully they're learning lessons early and not ruining their lives.
What's too early? How old do you think is too early?
I don't know. It depends. For boys or for girls?
For boys.
For boys? What's too early for boys?
Two.
That's heavy, man. I don't know. Personally, I was a late bloomer, so I don't know. The thing is, man, usually biology will tell you, you know. At the end of the day, biology rules the day. You know, hormones, I think it's kind of individual for every kid. I mean, every kid knows when they're ready, you know, at least physically.
Does in-school sex education help?
And generally speaking, I don't know. I know it helped me because my dad claims he gave me the talk. I don't remember. I don't remember ever hearing anything about sex from my dad. I had sex education in seventh grade, maybe sometime in middle school.
I know mostly in San Diego, it's sixth, eighth, 10th grade.
Yeah, that sounds about right. Yeah, I mean, it helped me.
I can almost guarantee you that had there not been sexual education in school, probably not a subject mom would have treaded on. In fact, I think it only got mentioned after I had mentioned something about sex education. It's, you know, because not having the whole father figure around, probably not one of those conversations mom wants to tread on.
Yeah. The only thing I could
especially
say,
being in a tweaker fucking power trip.
You're lucky something crazy didn't happen, like you were forced to have sex at like 8 years old and like they captured it on video and sold it on. You got, I mean, as terrible as it was, you probably got lucky.
Yeah, no. I always say fucking shit could have been a whole lot worse.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, you know, and I wouldn't wish what I went through on anyone, but you know, it kind of shaped me to how I think and how I perceive things, and it could have been a lot worse. I mean, fucking. Like, one thing I'm really glad about my mom, she never forced religion down my throat. I mean, she'd send me off to church to fucking probably so she can get high or whatever. But hey, at church, I got to eat. I had graham crackers and peanut butter, bitches, all right? And I was only there for like 2 hours, so, you know.
Bomb-ass church, man. I never got nothing like that.
Oh, yeah, they picked us up on a fucking bus and fucking drove us to church. And I still remember a fucking couple of Bible passages, although I don't remember, like, you know, them teaching us what it meant. I just remember I had fucking graham crackers and peanut butter.
It was good shit. On that note, you're lucky, because that could have been a lot worse. But for boys, do you have an opinion on that? What's too early for boys?
I think, like, you know, I think parents should talk about it probably, and it's really, really bad that it's getting younger and younger now, fucking where, you know, girls are starting to develop a lot younger now.
Well, girls have always developed before boys.
Right, but not as extreme as it has been. I mean, you're right. Hearing about fucking, you know, 7 and 8 year olds, you know, sprouting a set. And so, I mean, I think that once, you know, boys and girls start, you know, I think third grade, because that's kind of, you know, when I don't know. I mean, you know, I was never one of the whole cooties thing. You know, it wasn't like, ew, girls for me. It was like, all right, girls, I'm a breast man. What do you want? But, you know, it's just very weird.
I think it's very individual on the child. You know, every child has their sexual awakening at different times. There's a general age, I think.
Yeah.
But, you know, yeah, it's very specific to your child.
There's a line here. And there's no gender gap between the teen boys and the teen girls. There's a myth that guys are out on the prowl, and that's not supported by this data. Guess what? After seventh grade, there are guys on the prowl.
It's genetic, man. It's biological. It's absolutely. Now, it does vary from you know, every boy. But, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of – I think we forget that there's a lot of biological hormonal stuff going on at that age. But the trick is, I think, to, you know, even though the kids are ready biologically, physically at a young age, emotionally they're not ready.
Right.
So it's the parents' job to prepare them emotionally and, dare I say, spiritually and, you know, all that other stuff.
No. To, I'm God and bitch you not.
to be ready for that.
I'm getting a song ready.
Yeah, a lot of, I mean, until we have a set standard, I mean, the only thing we can go to look at is the law. You know, what does the law say? And actually, the law has been changing. The ages have gone down a little bit. It used to be, I believe it used to be 18.
They actually have a site called ageofconsent.com.
Yeah, it used to be 18 straight across the board, set in stone. Now, not only is it, I think a lot of the majority of states is 16, and there's also different.
Arkansas is 6.
Are you serious?
No.
Thank God.
I'm missing my teeth.
But
Utah, like, it was either Utah or like fucking like a sect in Utah, like one of the fucking hardcore sects, Sects, S-E-C-T-S, was like 11. And I was reading Prohibition. Did you watch it?
Nah, I never got a chance.
Prohibition was fucking good. That Prohibition.
Prohibition sucked.
Well, Prohibition, the show, the miniseries that was on PBS a while back.
Yeah.
In like Vermont or New York or fucking one of the states out east, age of consent back in like the 1850s was 11.
In the 1850s?
Yeah.
Okay, that kind of makes sense.
I guess.
Well, here's the thing, man.
A 20-year-old girl in the 1850s still looked like a 10-year-old boy.
But the thing is, you have to look at society and the way society is structured at certain points. We live in a society now where, you know, our children are allowed to be children for extended periods of time. We have, you know, people that are starting families at 35, 40 years old. In that time, man, you know, even if you go back even further, there are societies where children are regarded as adults or are given responsibilities, you know, particularly in a country like Mexico or
USA
or Europe. You have people.
Europe's a continent.
Whatever. But you have, you know, children are looked at differently. Children are more respected and more allowed to kind of start their families younger and, you know, basically to take part in society. Whereas, you know, modern day, our children don't really take part in society until much, much later. You know, we're soft Americans. We have, you know, some of us are allowed to stay and have our childhood last well into our 30s.
Apparently we have two listeners right now. One of them is Reverend Dom. Sorry we're not in the little chat box thing, Dom. But, yeah. And there's another listener out there, so
yeah.
Hola.
Hello, other listener.
What did you say, nigga?
So it's a different culture, different society, different structure to the society. So I can see how under certain circumstances that would be okay. But modern day, absolutely not. That's fucking full-on pedophilia, modern day.
Now, back to my whole fucking, if you listened to me many months ago, my whole equal, everyone wants to be equal, no one wants equality. The new study contains more encouraging news. For the first time, there was no racial difference in the percentage of girls reporting that they had sex. In the past, black females were more likely than whites to be sexually experienced.
Did they say why?
Here's a quote. That's due to a drop in black females who were sexually experienced, said the study's lead author, Gladys Martinez. A demographer for the government's National Center for Health Statistics.
Okay, they didn't really say anything there.
No, they didn't. But it was just like, hey, we want to point out that, like, you know, black women aren't having sex as young anymore. It's like, okay, well, what about white women? Why do you got to fucking separate them?
Well, because black are, well, let me think this through.
You could.
Again, culture has to come into play because if you come from a culture, a less modern culture, or usually different cultures other than white people, are encouraged to have a lot of kids and to have them early because that's what's going to take care of you in the future. You know, that's what's going to...
I thought that's just because you didn't have a TV. For those who don't know, my friend Fabian told me, and for the most part, I've always seen it's true, that Mexicans from Mexico, you can tell if they have a TV or not, because if they have one or two kids, they had a TV. If they have more than that, they didn't, because if they had one or two kids, then they got to sit around and watch TV, and if they had, you know, they didn't have the TV, well, they're sitting around and fucking.
Yeah, there's not much else to do. A lot of working on the farm and a lot of fucking.
Other findings in this story. Teens were less likely to have sex if they lived with both parents. I can
obvious one there.
Yeah. Most teens, 70% of girls and 56% of boys, had their first sex with someone who they were, quote, going steady. I graduated high school in 1999. I don't think I ever used the words going steady.
That's 1940s, 1950s?
Uh-huh. That's like fucking... what was that movie?
I'm thinking like Archie comics.
Yeah. What was the name of that movie? Fucking,
well, Welcome to Pleasantville.
Thank you. Pleasantville. Yeah. Fucking see, he knows. We're going steady. I'll give you my class ring.
the Letterman jackets.
Yeah, Letterman jackets were done in the 90s too. Okay.
Yeah, but they were more prevalent, and they were it was a big deal in the 1940s.
Fucking expensive.
Yeah. But the other question I have would be, what are they calling, what are they referring to as sex? Because there's also been plenty of reports that a lot of young people are having just oral sex or just doing like hand jobs and shit. Rather than full on, you know, penetration.
That's a good question.
Full on penetration.
Dog.
Fuck it.
Some teenage girls are trying newer contraceptive methods even the first time they have sex. A small but growing proportion of girls, 6% in the new survey, reported using long-acting hormonal methods such as injectable birth control, contraceptive patches, or the new contraceptive ring.
I don't have kids, but so I'm obviously going to be biased here, but I think, man, kids are going to fuck when they're going to fuck. You know, they know when it's time, and they're going to get around it somehow. So,
and especially like fucking late middle school and early high school, or fucking, and it's so funny because you take the time from when my mom was in high school to when I was in high school, fucking the peer pressure fucking gained exponentially. And now from the time that I was in high school till when Brielle hits high school, fucking peer pressure is going to skyrocket even more. It's like, oh my god, fucking, and especially now, fucking, you know, oh my god, he defriended me on Facebook. I'm gonna kill myself.
But it's also the way our society has moved. I mean, we're.
By the way, Mr. Musician, do people dent their microphones on purpose?
Not that I know of.
I watched Why? I watched Airheads for the first time the other night.
Okay. Why?
Because it was in my movie collection. And
isn't it a Pauly Shore movie?
Airheads?
I don't know. I've never
seen Airheads it. Is Brendan Fraser, Steve Buscemi, and Adam Sandler. The guys who fucking, you know, they hold up the radio station.
Yeah, I've never seen it.
It's pretty good. It's really funny. I think you'd enjoy it.
It's a comedy?
It's a comedy.
Yeah, I don't do too many comedies, so it'd have to be really good.
Well, I think you'd dig this one.
Okay, might give it a shot.
A Pauly Shore movie. Ugh.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I don't know, man.
I wouldn't waste good airtime talking about Pauly Shore movies. Okay, you were saying?
You were saying something. Dented
point. Microphone.
Oh, dented microphone.
Yeah, no, in the opening credits, fucking. And most of the time I've seen, like, microphones, there's, like, a dent on the side. And I looked down at my microphone, and I'm like, no, man.
We'd have to get Fabian in here because he would know about that. I'm not a singer. I'm a bass player.
Oh, well, I just figured, you know, general musician. Reverend Dom even considers Airheads a great movie.
Well, if it has Reverend Dom's endorsement, then fuck
I'm
it.
I'm God, and bitch you not.
I love that one.
Then I guess I'll be watching Airheads.
Yeah. Okay, another San Diego story. Ashton Kutcher's alleged one-night stand breaks her silence. And I'm not going to even go through this. Yeah. Apparently, Ashton Kutcher, on his 6th wedding anniversary, fucked some local groupie at the Hard Rock. Listen to this.
At the club?
Yeah, the bitch's name is Sarah Leal. Leal claimed that she and a friend got naked in a hot tub with Kutcher, and later he hinted he was interested in a threesome. After her trip to the bathroom, Leal claimed her friend left, and she had unprotected sex with Kutcher. He was good. We weren't, like, making love, but it wasn't weird or perverted.
Is this chicken what I have, or is this fish? I know it's tuna, but it says chicken by the sea.
That's the voice I hear when I read that story.
Yeah, exactly.
Afterwards, she claimed the two talked about politics.
Cut that bitch off!
He asked...
This story is too much.
He asked if I could name up-and-coming candidates. I said Rick Perry. The bitch named the governor from Texas. The guy who fucking hunts at a retreat. You know what the name of the retreat was?
No.
And Niggerhead.
Fuck you, asshole.
And they own it. Weird.
This is a legit politician?
Rick Perry is the governor of Texas. He's like George Bush, you know, Jr. Leo claimed the two were intimate again, and later he started to try to look through her cell phone text messages. She said she had texted a friend and told the pal she was partying with the actor. He said flat out, see, this stuff I can't, this is stuff I can't have happen. I offered to delete them. She said, claiming a bodyguard came in and took her phone away, promising her she'd get it back when she left. The last thing I remembered him saying was he did a good job. We woke up and I was wearing a robe. He opened it up and I was like, what are you doing? He was like, just checking. Okay, I did good. You're really pretty. Okay, now I'm going to skip.
Why are we wasting time with this?
Because I wanted to read this line right here. She said before the encounter that he had separated from his wife. If they're happily married, then I feel bad. No, you fucking don't. You goddamn fucking star chaser.
That's called woman logic.
You star fucker. Woman logic.
Yeah, no, she probably does feel bad, but that's justification. Oh, dear God. What is this?
I threw that picture on there for shock value. Not having anything to do with this next story, but family lost in Massachusetts corn maze calls 911 for help. Apparently, somewhere in Massachusetts, there's this, like, fucking 7-mile-long corn maze. And it takes an hour to get from the front to the back on average.
They couldn't find the North Star?
And they called 911. Just thought I'd throw that in there.
Darwin, where are you when we need you?
Darwin was nowhere around when... Woman accused of calling ex 1,001 times in 3 months. And I was reading this story, and as I read it, I'm like, oh my God, Prima's going to love this. Okay. Police say Tony Joe Sylvie, this woman is god ugly, still reeling from a 2009 breakup with Houston leather artist Peter Main, also created an internet persona, Wounded Poetic Soul.
Oh, this is great.
And that turned out to be very wounded indeed.
But what is a leather artist?
I don't know. Some guy who fucking butchers cows
that
for the fuck of it.
Like bondage related or something.
Cut that bitch off!
Maine, 62, did not respond to a voicemail or an email seeking comment. Maine told police that he officers he dated Sylvie briefly in 2009 and has been reluctant to file charges against her because, quote, he is afraid of angering her further. Listen to this.
What a bitch.
Maine told police Sylvie called him 1,001 times and sent him 712 emails over the span of 3 months.
Has this idiot not heard of filters and fucking, you know, apps for blocking calls?
One day in August, she allegedly called him 146 times. According to the probable cause affidavit in the case, Sylvie started a blog in June where she vacillated between name calling, waxing philosophical about the end of their relationship, and openly taunting Maine. The blog includes excerpts of what appeared to be emails between Maine and another woman. Maine reported that his email account was hacked in February. Maine told police he did not change his phone or email because he is self-employed and, quote, it would be detrimental to his business. Bullshit.
What happened to men in this country?
It's the pussification of fucking America. George Carlin called it 20 years ago. 30 years ago. 40 years ago, maybe. He told police he saw Sylvie shatter the leaded glass windows near his front door with a tire iron in July. He also said she smashed a kitchen window with a tire iron on August 3rd, and then returned 4 days later and broke another kitchen window with a 5-foot sword. The same day, she rammed her Chevy Blazer into his parked car, slamming it into the garage door and causing about $915 in damage.
See, Hollywood, instead of making remakes and movies based on short stories and books, needs to take shit like this, because this is some psycho shit. This is a good movie.
Maine also reported his house being egged several times and gave police a screenshot of Sylvie allegedly bragging about it on her Facebook page.
Oh my God. Is this chicken what I have, or is this fish?
This is okay, USA.
Proof that not everyone should have internet access.
Oh, this gets better. In an interview with police, Sylvie reportedly told the officer to read my blog, it's all there.
Fuck it.
The police officer reviewed the blog and online and found numerous references to damages to the complainant's property. That afternoon, Maine reported to police that Sylvie was back throwing eggs at his driveway.
But bitches be crazy, man. And this one be ugly.
This is god ugly. Vitamin E pills linked with prostate cancer risk.
That does not surprise me at all.
See, one of the things that, you know, that will prevent, you know, lower your chances of getting prostate cancer is eating a high amount of tomatoes and tomato-based products.
Right, lycopene.
One of the other things that can increase your chances of getting prostate cancer is drinking a lot of milk.
Really?
Grandpa's got prostate cancer.
He does?
Yes.
I thought he had it in his leg or something.
No, he had some sort of fucking cancer in his leg, but he's got fucking prostate cancer. Or had or something like that. I don't know. I don't keep track of it. But he, they told him, you know, that, you know, drinking a lot of milk actually increases your chance of getting prostate cancer.
Do they know exactly what it is in milk that does that?
No. They might, but nothing I paid attention to. I like this. This guy talking about, people tend to think of vitamins as innocuous substances, almost like chicken soup. Take a little and it can't hurt. If you have normal levels, the vitamin is probably of no benefit, and if you take too much, you can be harmed. Well then, fucking all these, you know, drug companies bringing out vitamins for every fucking thing are actually killing people, but maybe that was their fucking intended purpose.
The thing is, it's in everything now. Like, any processed food is, like, fortified or whatever with extra vitamins. It's all shit. It's all shit that our bodies don't need.
Now, I want to go over a couple of the things that I brought up today.
So don't take vitamin E, men. Women, take all you want.
The headline of the story is, please welcome the rise of the automatic gratuity.
I briefly saw this, and I didn't want to get pissed off, so I didn't read it.
Oh, I fucking brought it up to point out some of the facts and to ask you about some of them.
Facts. Oh, there are facts in this.
The way they're approaching it and, you know, being a person who partakes in, you know, ingesting spirits at a local facility or facilities.
Oh, that's different. If I'm going to a bar, that's different than going out to dinner.
Right.
Go ahead. Okay. We'll talk about that later.
No. Let's see. It's easier because you won't end up paying double. Because some people, when they're drunk, actually fucking fail to realize, especially if they've gone out as a group, that most of the time, in this story it says six or more. Every place I've been is eight or more. Automatic gratuity, which fucking means if we would have had like two more people at our lunch, it would have been automatic gratuity, and I wouldn't have worried about it. But fucking, they deserve the $20. That was good food. I want to go back soon. But I can totally understand that point where, like, it, you know, fucking, if it's automatically included, then hey, whatever.
Yeah, but what are they basing? What's the scale they're using? How much are they adding?
Like 18%.
18%.
Yeah.
What's the normal thing that people tip? Wasn't it 15?
It was 15, and they used to say, you know, just double the tax. But if you double the tax in El Cajon, it's 19.
Jeez.
Yeah, so.
What's the basis behind this? Because all restaurants are required by law to pay their waiters and waitresses. At least minimum wage,
mm-hmm.
and then what they get from tips is, you know.
Yeah.
But here's the other thing. Waiters and waitresses are notorious for not reporting all their money.
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah. So what's
the
problem?
Shit, neither are arcade attendants.
So what's the problem? Why are they doing this? And
because they're thinking about fucking just making it, you know, one straight thing across the table, kind of like sales taxes.
But isn't that the way it is in Europe, I think, or...
Fuck Europe.
Or Japan. I think Japan, you're not supposed to, you don't take.
Okay, USA.
We're not talking about Europe.
What? Why not?
Because this is America.
Yeah, but those countries are advanced in different ways than we are. Well, America's on the downfall.
Yeah, go to Greece. They're not really farther ahead than we are.
That's why I said in certain things. Certainly in culture and society, societal norms.
The current standard of a dollar a drink, especially when paying in cash over the bar, has been in place for years. Even as drink prices and rents keep rising, the automatic gratuity brings the tip up to the industry standard without awkward looks from jilted service staff. Back in 2009, Frank Bruni brought up the debate, pointing to a post on Down by the Hipster, where readers overwhelmingly voted in favor of the bucket drink rule. Bruni points out why this is outdated. Here's the quote. Now that many cocktails and glasses of wine indeed approach $15. Really?
If you go to a classy joint, yeah. If you go to a trendy bar or something like that. Yeah, definitely. Especially...
How much did my fucking Roy Rogers cost you at the fucking the soda bar?
Maybe. I don't know. I don't remember. But no. That's a dive bar. So that's totally different. That's
first bar I've ever been thrown out of.
Through no fault of your own.
Through no fault of my own.
But yeah, at a bar like that, any drink will be $4 or $5.
The dollar per drink rule means that someone consuming $45 of alcohol could end up tipping $3, which is in vicinity of 7%. Yes, the bartender may not have raced around quite the same way a waiter or waitress does, but the bartender's cost of living is rising in sync with the cost of those drinks. As they become more expensive, shouldn't his or her compensation go up?
That's a retarded fucking rule, because...
the dollar drink rule or the fucking go with the cost of living rule?
Everything you said, I mean, people tip a lot differently at a bar than at a restaurant, because there are a lot of people that are regulars or go to the bar, or people that have their favorite bartender. The dollar per drink rule is not always followed, and there's almost no way to track it. I mean, there's a lot of people that tip over that. There's a lot of people that tip under that. I've seen it mentioned.
Hey, three listeners.
I've seen it mentioned in a lot of blogs and a lot of articles about how to tip. You know, and this is something I personally do. If I show up to a bar, the very first time that I order a drink, I'll give them a heavy tip, maybe $10, maybe $15, maybe $20, because that's going to make him remember me. So next time I come up to the bar, he's going to say, "Hey, I'm going to go to that guy because I know that guy tips well." Or that guy, he'll recognize me, you know. Laying down a $20 tip right off the bat will make sure that you'll get good service. We'll make sure that he remembers you. And, you know, when the bar gets crowded and...
How will that work with, like, but how do you do subsequent tips after that?
Dollar drink.
Okay.
Yeah, after that it's dollar
drink. That I can understand.
The thing is, if you're going out to drink, you're going to drop money no matter what. You know, if you're trying to drink on the cheap, then what you do is you get a cheap bottle or a cheap can of beer or whatever, and you drink it in your car, and then you go in and have one or two drinks.
Reverend Dom says, I'm dead glad I don't drink anymore. I'd really be broke.
Yeah, it's an expensive habit, and if you're trying to go out and have a nice night on the town and trying to be cheap about it, fuck you. Stay home. Make your own fucking drinks.
And I don't get the whole going out to a bar thing in this following situation. If you're not going out for music and you're not going out for anything in particular, you're going out with a couple friends to a bar. That's it. I don't get that.
Why not?
Why don't you fucking just get drunk at home?
Well, bars.
Since I don't drink, I think of the financials of it.
Because it's all about set and setting, and it's all about atmosphere, and it's all about a social experience. You're going out. There's definitely a sense of. A sense of anything could happen, you know, when you go out to a bar like that with a bunch of friends. It's like, think about Cheers. Watch Cheers, you know. It's like the type of conversations that you're going to have at a bar with a couple friends are different than a conversation you would have anywhere else, you know. It's the same
with those same friends?
Yeah, with those same friends, definitely. Especially once alcohol is involved and the lips loosen a little bit, you know. You get into subjects that you might not get into ordinarily on the street.
And also, you can also if someone's there with a camera, you get really weird pictures.
Yeah, pictures, and especially if you're video, you know, if you're recording. I mean, people act differently in all different types of situations. It's the same thing with smokers. You know, smokers have their own little thing. Like if you meet up with friends and you're all smokers, or you meet up at a coffee shop and have cigarettes and coffee, it's a certain type of conversation that you're gonna have that's specific to that situation. So. Especially at a bar, especially particularly if you have a favorite bar that you go to,
mm-hmm.
and you know the bartender, or you know, it has your favorite pool table or your favorite arcade game. It's like a second home. It's like you feel comfortable there, and it's social. It's definitely very social. You might meet someone. You never know who you're gonna run into, or. You know, anything could happen. I think that's definitely it.
So fucking delicious.
To put it in a nutshell, anything could happen. It has a very adventurous spirit to it. And you will spend money.
See, this is the reason I wanted to ask you, because me, I don't have any fucking, I don't have any barometer on these things, you know, well, about going to a bar. I go to a bar and I'm just like, eh, I'm here to drive.
Okay, well, in your case, think about it like 1940s, 1950s when they had soda shops. You know, people would gather there at soda shops. You'd see people going on dates. You'd see people just hanging out, looking for something to get into.
Right.
You know, or an old a place like Sonic Burger, you know, a place where everyone would go on Saturday night and try to, you know, some people trying to hook up, some people just having dinner.
Or dumbass people like us driving 103 miles to go to Sonic's.
People showing off their cars, showing off their ladies, whatever. You know, it's a social gathering.
Well, and I get, I mean, I would totally understand the whole social fucking aspect of it. Had, you know, I'd not seen so many times friends of mine going to a bar to just sit and drink and talk with only those same people.
I've never done that too much. I've done it, but, yeah, it depends on the vibe of the bar, too. If you go into a bar and like I said, atmosphere, if you like the atmosphere, if you like either maybe the events that are going on, there's a lot of college bars that have, you know, ping pong tournaments.
Bringing up pictures of Primo drinking.
That show obscure movies on their TVs.
Zombie Lounge. Zombie Lounge. I loved going to the Zombie Lounge for that.
Yeah.
But I didn't go to the Zombie Lounge to drink. I went to the Zombie Lounge because Fabian wasn't driving.
But here's the thing, too. There's people drink for different reasons. I mean, you might go out saying, okay, I'm going to get fucked up. I'm going to drink. You know, that's what your purpose is there. You might go out, only have two or three drinks just to loosen up. Maybe there's a band playing, you want to dance or whatever. Maybe you're going out to hook up. There's a lot of people going out looking to get laid.
That's,
you know,
the picture I was looking for. I pulled up a picture that is on my Facebook page, and I'll go ahead and click share now and just repost it on my wall to show the elements of why Prima goes out and drinks with his friends.
You get some sweet man love going. That too, man.
Reverend Dom says he met Mrs. Rev at a bar, and they've been together for 11 years.
That's goddamn impressive, man. Usually the type of woman you meet at a bar is...
And that's one of the reasons that, like, fucking, it's, like, really difficult for me to get back into the whole dating scene. Don't drink. Won't meet a woman at a bar, and even if I did, I wouldn't want to fucking, you know, being sober, I wouldn't want to take anything I found at a bar home. Unless, like, although there was a couple waitresses at the Zombie Lounge.
Gosh. Those are hard to get.
Yeah.
Work on your game, sir. That's all you can do.
I've got game.
You have game.
I've got game.
Then it shouldn't be hard to get back in.
I'm not trying.
Oh. Well, wait, you just said one of the reason you...
It's one of those things that I look at when it's like, you know, hey, you know, let's get back into the fucking, you know, this scene. But I have so many, and I need to get rid of a couple of these rules. Okay.
Yes, you have a lot
Number
of rules.
One, I don't date anyone that my friends already know. And I do that because I don't want fucking situations where, you know, comparisons happen or fucking, you know, the whole fucking barbershop talk happens about me with fucking people I already know. There are certain things that my friends don't know that I would like to keep that way. That, and I had a situation where, and they didn't even know each other before. I got with a girl, I introduced her to my friends, and my friends fucking with that girl. Fuck that girl. So I'm just saying. Anyway. There's a couple more things on this news story I wanted to get at.
So you're not dating and you don't want to date.
I don't want to be alone, but I don't want to have to meet someone new.
You're proper fucked then, sir.
Right.
That's an
exactly. Yeah. So, you know, right now it's just like, okay, whatever.
And then you have the rule about not dating anyone that your friends know or anything like that. So you're effectively shooting yourself in the foot.
Pretty much. But it's better to, you know, I'm not happy being alone, but I'm content on not being hurt and disappointed.
Well, content is bullshit, sir.
Well, content fucking pays the rent. Barely. Barely, might I add. Once again, this podcast is sponsored by the State of California Employment Development Department because, well, they are paying all the bills right now.
They're buying my vinyl and cassettes.
Automatic does not mean mandatory. Bars and restaurants can call an automatic gratuity mandatory, but they can't make customers pay for it. A court case in 2004 demonstrated that customers still don't have to pay for it. That's when a Long Island man who left a 10% tip instead of the mandatory 18% was arrested and charged with theft of services. He fought the charge, and the judge dropped it, saying a tip or gratuity is discretionary, and that's what the courts have found.
So here's a question. If you take away the customer's option to tip the way he wants, how is the customer supposed to show his either gratitude for the service if it was good, or, you know, his contempt if it was terrible service?
I think it works in the exact kind of, you know, the other side of that room, where how does it make a server fucking not go above and beyond to try and be the one that deserves that high tip? Like, I know people who will start with a 20% tip, and fucking for every, like, you know, time they don't get their drink filled or right. fucking whatever, there it goes.
That's
it goes.
A pretty good system.
Yeah.
I like it.
And there are times, especially like when we went to Rey Dogado, it's like, hey, I didn't pay as much as I thought it was going to be for this meal. We had our waters filled at a decent rate, and fucking the waiters are nice, and they didn't sit anyone behind me, which was great.
Yeah.
So I tipped them.
And Isaiah fell in love.
And Isaiah fell in love and picked the wrong seat to fall in love with. So, yeah, I tipped. I think it ended up being I tipped like 25%.
That's good.
Yeah.
See, it goes with the ambiance of the place, experience, you know. The thing is, I think, you know, there's a lot of different factors that go into how someone is going to tip. And they're trying to get rid of that. They're trying to make it so, you know, it can be predictable how people are going to tip. I think it's bullshit. I don't think there's any need for it.
So you disagree with a mandatory automatic gratuity?
I do, absolutely.
Okay. And as do I. I really do. Because, I mean, there are some places. Story time. My sister worked at Olive Garden back in like 05, 06. And me and Tommy went out on a Friday night. And she's like, yeah, whenever you guys want to come here, fucking just give me a call and whatever. And there was an hour wait outside a fucking Olive Garden.
All right, typical for an Olive Garden.
And I called my sister. I said, hey, can you do anything about this? She says, give me 10 minutes. Give her 10 minutes. She had this fucking table. We got in front of the line, whatever.
Awesome.
Well, the reason she did that is she did it twofold. There was this woman who apparently was giving her a rough fucking, you know, just, you know, she wanted to, Tamara wanted to bash her face in. All right. And she's like, yeah, do you think you can be, you know, kind of to this one? It's like, hey, my sister got us a table at Olive Garden fucking 50 minutes beforehand, whatever. So I would have expected this from Beef, but not from Tommy. Tommy was just going fucking ballistic. This, you know, Tommy's like, oh yeah, do you guys have Coke here? No, we only serve Pepsi products. How can you call yourselves a restaurant if you don't serve fucking Coke products? What if the customer bubble, and he like just like, and he was doing stupid shit like fucking mixing the salt and pepper shakers. And so we were there for a while. We were there for hour and a half, you know, and I had to discover the hard way. Don't ever get the peach iced tea without ice at Olive Garden, because it's very, very warm. Yeah. So anyway, I ordered it. I'm like, yeah, I want a peach iced tea, no ice. Okay, no iced tea, no ice. Right. And I'm like, with people in the food industry, I'm very, very fucking respectful unless they fucking prove something to me that they don't deserve it.
Right. Right. That's a pretty good standard to go by.
This person, my sister, wanted me to be a dick to. So I was like, all right, well, whatever. I mean, I didn't go nearly as fucking hardcore as Tommy did, but whatever. Well, apparently this girl had enough about with us for about a half an hour. And she went on break. So another waitress came out and was taking care of us and whatever. And it's like, okay, blah, 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 blah. And we were cool to her, right?
Right.
And all of a sudden, after about a 45-minute break, because my sister's like, yeah, apparently she went on break. Because she was like,
45 minutes?
Like, apparently something happened after that, too. And it's like, okay, well, whatever. So what ended up happening is toward the end of the meal, the original waitress came back and fucking we were mixing drinks and fucking doing, you know, bullshit, making her fucking, you know, hey, this drink isn't right. No, I want ice in my drink this time.
Right.
Why do you guys still not serve Coke products? And so Tamara came out, you know, she's like, hey, everything all right? And then she hugged me right in front of the waitress. And the waitress, obviously, okay, you know, fucking.
Yeah, she got what was going
on. Yeah. And I told Tamara, I said, okay, how does tipping work? Does the original waitress get it? And she's like, unfortunately, yeah, that's how it works. The original waitress, no matter who's at the end, the original waitress would get the tip. I said, all right, here's what I want you to get me. I want you to get me a cup of ice water, a coaster. And I gave her, like, the tip. And I said, give this to the second waitress that helped us, because she deserves this.
How much was the tip?
I think I left, like, 15 or 20. Yeah, she was really cool. And that, and I love their peach iced tea, and she fucking, like, had it all the way. And so what I did was Tamara brought me this fucking, the coaster, the glass of water. And what I did is I dug in my pocket and I grabbed all the change I had, which was 36 cents, 16 of it in pennies. I dropped them in the ice water, put the coaster on top of the cup, put the cup upside down on the table, and the coaster. To where now the cup of water is upside down on the table with that waitress's tip inside. And then we left. And apparently Tamara got fired a couple days later because she bashed the bitch's face in.
Oh, she actually got in
the fight. Yeah. Hey, we didn't have to wait an hour at Olive Garden, so.
Oh, fucking moral of the story, Olive Garden sounds good right now.
Indeed, and they fucking just ended their fucking pasta bowl. And I don't get paid again until the 25th. Lindsay Lohan kicked out of community service. Now, here's one, and I want to get your opinion on this. Larry Hagman of Dallas and of I Dream of Jeannie, if you guys want to go old school, diagnosed with cancer. Never seen Dallas. Really? Neither have I, but I knew who fucking J.R. Ewing was. But you've seen I Dream of Jeannie.
Am I off?
It sounded like you were.
You're
on now.
Yeah.
Weird. Anywho. On I Dream of Jeannie, he was the main character.
Oh, really?
Yeah, not Barbie Eden, but the fucking the Air Force guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, he's been diagnosed with cancer, and I'm like, oh, okay, that kind of sucks, you know, whatever. And then the next,
kinda sucks.
Well, here, like, here's the next part of the story. The 80-year-old actor is famous for playing J.R. Ewing on Dallas. And I don't mean to sound heartless, but is it really fucking newsworthy that an 80-year-old gets cancer? It's kind of like, you know, at 80, you're already past your life expectancy.
What is life expectancy?
For a man in the United States, it's like 74.
So he's kind of beating the Reaper by a couple of years.
Right. And I'm just looking at this. I'm like, well, he's 80 and he got cancer.
Well, I think the reason they're reporting it is because of who he is and his experience on television, not because he's, you know, it's not like he's some random guy from Pasadena that got diagnosed with cancer.
By the way, fuck Steve Jobs. I'm not saying I'm glad he's dead. I'm not saying that what he went through fucking wasn't bad or whatever like that. But that snide, smart-ass, fucking trendy motherfucker, I'm not sad that he died. It sucks that he died, but fucking you won't see me going all up in arms and putting Apple logos on my fucking shit.
What was your problem with him?
People who actually, like, really needed fucking, would ask for insight or fucking, you know, ask for something. And, you know, he put his email address for the public to ask him without. To me, that part right there, hey, cool. You got the fucking, the founder's email address.
Right.
But some of the snide remarks he'd fucking say to these people who actually, like, wanted insight or fucking even asked for history or fucking whatever assistance, the snide remarks he'd fucking reply to these people, it's not very befitting of a person of that much influence.
Okay, I haven't seen him. I don't know. I don't even know what you're talking
about. Yeah, I mean, like one of them was like, you know, hey, I was actually wondering about this and this and this and this. And it was actually like history of the company or history of the guy or, right, you know, whatever like that. And he writes back instead of saying like, I'm sorry, I'm unable to do this, or I'm sorry, I don't have time. He wrote back and it was, and I'm paraphrasing this, but, he put, that's not the reason I'm here. It's like you could have taken that, as someone of that much influence, you could have taken that so many more directions and been a little bit more proper with it instead of fucking alienating yourself from people like that. A person who's like legitimately asking for your help, you can tell them no in so many, you know, ways, but it's like to say, hey, you know, fucking fuck you, that's not what I'm here for. It's just, it just rubbed me the wrong way. That and fucking, you know, Apple gets way too much credit for fucking inventing things. Apple made things that already existed trendy. And I don't like Apple's business practices of flash and refusal for third-party development. Besides that, I have no problem with Apple, except for iTunes. iTunes is an unnecessarily memory-intensive piece of shit program, which I actually fucking installed on my computer last night to test something. And it took 20 minutes to install and uninstall. And when I went to go sign up for the Apple ID, I confirmed the email address 3 fucking times, and it says, you haven't confirmed your Apple ID. I'm like, you know what? I've already run my test. Fuck this program.
Well, your opinion, you're entitled to it.
Oregon Trail.
Carmen San Diego.
Cross Country USA. Hell yeah. And then this one. I love this one. The cost of the NBA lockout by numbers.
There was an NBA lockout?
There is an NBA lockout.
Really?
The season is supposed to start in a couple weeks, and they've already canceled the first 2 weeks of the season. Yeah, they're not gonna play it this season.
Good. Who cares?
Okay. Here's the number. $4 billion is the major point of dispute in negotiations is how to share the NBA's total revenue. There have been 100 total games scrapped by canceling just the first 2 games of the season, or first 2 weeks of the season. $1 million is the amount in revenue that the Sacramento Kings lose per canceled game.
Good. Awesome.
$719,502 is the amount lost in ticket sales per canceled game.
Wonderful.
$70,000, amount lost in parking revenue per canceled game.
Exciting.
$208,359, amount lost in vendor sales per canceled game.
Fuck you, vendors.
$350 million is the amount per month the players will collectively lose during the lockout.
Screw you, team.
$1.9 million is the amount that Los Angeles Lakers, you know, has been Kobe Bryant loses because of the 2 week cancellation, most of any player.
God forbid.
$83.5 million is the value of Kobe's 3-year contract. While it's hard to label multimillionaire NBA players as victims, says, you know, this guy named Reed, it's also difficult to imagine losing a paycheck that amounts to an unfathomable fortune every 2 weeks.
Come on, Reed.
Come on, Reed. Let's see. $807 million is the amount advertisers spent on NBA broadcasts last season, a number that dwindles with each canceled game. 204 days is how long the previous 1998 NBA lockout lasted. 105 days is the current lockout so far.
I hope it goes on forever.
Yeah. there were 50 games played in 1998, and there were supposed to be 82. So, I mean, like, it's costing a lot of people a lot of money, and they're just wondering what to do with all these fucking...
Costing, you know, a lot of people a lot of money because they want more money.
Right.
It's all about money.
Right.
Rich people that already have tons of money asking for more money.
1%, 99.
There you go.
And we still have 3 listeners, so hello to our 3 listeners, Reverend Dom and the Mystery 2.
The Mystery 2.
Actually, I can find out.
That sounds like a band, Reverend Dom and the Mystery 2.
Actually, I can find out who this is. Who is this? This is someone. It's someone from Waterbury, Connecticut.
Wow, they still like you, somewhat over there in Connecticut.
Maybe Dom's just listening on 3 different devices. My phone is still dying. Let's see who this is. Someone from Salt Lake City, Utah. I don't know anyone from. I know one person from Utah, but and someone from Hartford, Connecticut.
There you go.
So, yeah, so Dom's listening twice, and we got someone in fucking Mormon country.
Dom's listening twice.
All right, so what we're going to do now.
Did we even properly intro this podcast?
We ran a theme.
We did provide a mission statement or a disclaimer.
Hey, if you subscribe to the podcast on a podcast reader like iTunes or Zune or any of those, our mission statement is pretty simple. In fact, I'll pull up our mission statement.
Well, I wasn't even consulted.
I'm pretty sure you'll enjoy this.
I better.
I think you will. Let me pull up Zune.
God, Zune. Yeah.
What's your problem with Zune?
iPod win.
Zune is actually discontinued, so iPod does win. I don't like iTunes.
Yeah, you've said that many times before.
I would not have a problem owning an iPod if not for iTunes. That and I like the Zune Pass. $10 a month, unlimited songs.
That is what sticks in my fucking craw, sir.
What?
You pay for music in this age. There's no need for that at all.
I pay for hard-to-find music in this age.
Oh, fuck that, dude. Hard-to-find. There's
this and comedy.
This is the internet age. There is no hard-to-find music.
You know,
I don't understand.
I met this man 4 years ago. It's been that long. I met this man 4 years ago, right? And the idea of internet to him wasn't foreign. It was just
dial-up.
And when he got broadband, all of a sudden he became the fucking Dalai Lama of high-speed internet.
Of internet memes, of online piracy, of... you know what? I learned a lot of it from you and a lot from Fabian. I don't know. I just took it somewhere else, I guess. Oh, my God. Heavenly blessed beauty.
Okay. Our mission statement. Designated Dave, a nickname given to him because he doesn't drink and he's usually the driver, is outspoken about many topics.
Why do you always talk about yourself in the third person?
It's a fucking mission statement. I'm not putting I.
Oh, okay.
Shut up. Is outspoken about many topics. He doesn't believe in sugarcoating his opinions and very rarely has filters on what he thinks. Primo is a deep thinker with ideals that a lot of normal people would find irregular, if not offensive. Together, these two tackle...
You call me a deep thinker? What the fuck is wrong with you?
Together, these two tackle news, sports, and whatever else happens to get mentioned in conversation. If you have a closed mind, this isn't for you. If your mind is open, we hope you're entertained and maybe even informed.
We haven't even talked about DMT yet.
We could, actually. I saw an article about that.
No, we'll do that
Reverend
next time.
Reverend Dom says he's only listening on one PC. All right, so what I'm going to do before we get into our final segment is I'm going to play a couple songs.
Oh, shit. Final segment.
Final segment.
Are we almost done?
We got a couple things on mixed martial arts, which you haven't been paying attention to lately, so you'll probably be informed too.
Right.
But what I'm going to do is we have to be very careful about what we record and what we stream, and I'm pretty sure I would probably have permission to play anything by Dive Bomber because they're not signed to a major label. Yeah. And I do most of their photography.
I think we're clear on this one.
Yeah, and I was supposed to be at a show tonight, but you know, we decided not to go. Money issues. And it's in Garden Grove. That's a fucking drive.
Yeah, EDD pays the bills, but does not always afford for luxuries.
Exactly. So the two songs I picked are Voice and Elaine, and I picked those songs because, well, I did the videos on... I did half the video on Elaine, and I did most of the video for Voice, which will be put together from our friend Bob Marino at OFNR Studios very soon. As in, you should be getting your package very soon. So you're on the Rusty Razor podcast. It is 11:20 p.m. It's funny not saying a call sign or any affiliation we happen to be,
We could make one up.
We could. The STFU Radio Network.
There you go. That's a good idea.
Yeah. So here's a couple songs by Dive Bomber, and we'll be back probably in about 10 minutes. And I forgot, I've got two mics on, so let me turn yours off and go into the song and turn mine off.
Coming up in the underground, I was more than a witness. I absorbed the message and I held it in. It became my hostage. For I felt silent for many years. I bear witness as I reappear loud and clear. With all of this power in the palm of my hands, I rip up my veins and I shower. I've made the adjustments. I'm coming back, all you can be sure.
just about lost your mind, but just forget them. They don't know that it's our time. With all of this power in the palm of my hands, I'll break my muffins and I shower. I am the voice of the people. I am the voice of the crowd. I speak the mind of the masses. I am the voice of the crowd. I speak the mind of the masses. I made the call to Metro. They said, got a bed for you. It'll just take 3 days. I'll be there. In the jungle, where we just about lost our mind, you saved my head, man. I pay you back now, it's our time. With all of this power in the palm of my hands, I rip up my face and I shower. I am the voice of the people. I am the voice of the crowd. I speak the mind of the masses. Of the people, I am the voice of the crowd. I speak the mind of the masses. You planted the seed, the knowledge it grows. I rip off my heart. Now everyone knows. They see right through me. They see what is true. The place where my heart was. It's glowing with you. I am the voice of the people. I am the voice of the crowd. I speak the mind of the masses. I am the voice of the people. I am the voice of the crowd. I speak the mind of the masses. I am the voice of the people. I am the voice of the crowd.
I can truly say I gave it all just for you, Elaine.
Mike's back live. And stop the music. Two songs by Dive Bomber, where I was supposed to be at their show tonight, but it was too far of a drive, and I'm flat broke. And that's how that happens. Which reminds me, this show is still sponsored by the California State Employment Development Department, because they are paying all the bills and paying for things that people on unemployment should not be getting. Did you see that picture I posted on your wall?
Which one?
Ultimate Warrior.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's at Soundcheck, that fucking record store we went
where
into.
Where I got the tape,
yeah.
The Circle Jerks tape.
Yeah. I was like, fuck.
That's a weird place to have.
Yeah, they said it was like it was only going to be limited to like 25 people.
Oh, shit.
But it's like, fuck, man. That would have been like...
What date is it on?
October 29th, the day of the zombie walk, the day of the fucking... Fuck. The day of the Ramona show.
It's just really putting a cramp in my style, man.
Crapping your style, you're going to be in TJ.
Hopefully, yeah. I don't know how it's going to work out. Now we're kind of counting on your camera and your skills. But
which camera? Both of them?
Video camera.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Because I am like, you know, I'd be with you guys, so I really wouldn't be worried about it. I'm not worried about it like at all, because right. I actually want to take the rig.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Down to fucking TJ and get some shots.
Yeah.
Definitely no way I'm doing that by myself. You know, I'm a big guy, but it's TJ. They do that shit for a living.
Yeah.
All right. So we got some mixed martial arts to cover, and I'm not going to cover the last 4.5 months because it'd just be a lot. But I'm going to start off with one story. Joe-san suspected in killing a prison mate. Have you ever seen the movie Austin Powers?
Yeah. Awkward, most awkward cinema experience of my life.
Random test, the dude who threw the shoe?
Yeah, yeah.
He used to be an MMA fighter.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. Not a good one at all. He actually had a record of 0-4. In fact, he was choked out at UFC 4 after taking a lot of shots to the groin by a fucking...
Oh, I've seen that fucking fight.
Really?
Yeah, that was one of the first UFC fights I ever saw.
Yeah, fucking he kept taking nut shot, and the dude choked him out.
Yeah, yeah, dude was wearing like red panties.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that too.
Okay. Well, Joe-san is actually doing a life sentence for the 1990 gang rape of a woman who was walking her dog. I don't know why they put the fact that she was walking her dog. I mean, you know, maybe it's a statistic. More women are raped who are walking their dogs than not. So if you don't want to get raped, don't walk your dog.
Possible. Either out jogging or walking the dog.
But, well, he's suspected in killing his prison mate. Now, he's doing life for a 1990 gang rape. The dude he supposedly killed was doing 2 years for failing to register as a sex offender. I get the whole fucking criminal code, but how is one sex offender going to kill another sex offender?
Well, we don't know the details.
I don't know. Maybe if you're shooting him.
Well, and it depends on what... I just got...
Took you a couple seconds for that one.
Well, failing to register as a sex offender, we don't know what he did. If he was after... even a gang rapist will go after a child rapist, you know?
Yeah. Whatever.
The shoe-throwing guy from Austin Powers?
Yeah.
What the fuck?
I do have to say this because Reverend Dom, I believe, is still listening. He asked me this earlier. He asked me what I thought about Sons of Anarchy. And I said, easily one of my top 10 shows of all time.
Wow.
Easily.
Huh. Does Entourage make that list?
Entourage is like top 3.
Just checking.
No, like top 3 or like, you know, Entourage, like no, in no particular order, Entourage... the original Knight Rider. Come on. I'm talking...
That fucking reused footage in every fucking
hell yes,
episode.
Fucking stock footage, dude. It's Glenn Larson at his best. Anyone who watched the old school Battlestar Galactica, fucking that's where he got the idea for Kit Scanner from, is the robot from Battlestar Galactica.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah. You've seen the original, right?
What, Battlestar?
Uh-huh.
No, I've seen the newer one.
Okay, well, I haven't seen the newer one, so I don't know if they still have the same robot. But it was a robot with the fucking one thing going... Vroom, vroom, vroom.
I've seen it. They still have the light thing, but the robots look different now.
Yeah, that's where you got the idea for the kit scanner. So not only did he use a fucking... Not only does he use stock footage, he uses stock ideas and fucking...
Recycles ideas.
Yeah. So...
Wow.
Well, you know, whatever. Thundercats... Probably not top three. But, you know, I'm just thinking of shows that I really, really liked. Prison Break was my favorite show when it was on. But, like, I got into Sons of Anarchy, and it's just like, holy
what
shit.
What season are you on?
I finished season two.
Oh, the one with Henry Rollins. Fuck yeah.
Yeah. And that's why I'm sitting there, and I was sending you messages. I'm like, dude, Henry Rollins. And then fucking, dude, the way he went out at the end.
Oh,
he
yeah.
Was all, he was, I mean, that was hard.
That shit was powerful.
Fucking, he's just the, you know, he doesn't see this, right? Like, fuck. Yeah. And like, fucking, I know Dom swears by that show. But yeah, that show's fucking wicked. And I, you know, Dom gave me a fucking site to, you know, to download season three. Unfortunately, it uses torrents, and torrents use trackers, and I can't download torrents because I'm afraid, you know, because it's not my ISP I'm using. So.
Oh, that's right.
So. Yeah. Actually, you know what? I might just switch over to the phone because the phone downloads fucking quick anyway. In fact, that's what I was doing for the past month.
Aren't you on newsgroups though?
My subscription lapsed, and the California State Employment Development Department hasn't quite given me the money to cover that yet.
Oh, wow. You can wait then.
Yeah. Yeah, that'll all be set up fucking back on the...
Is your Netflix selective?
That lapsed on the 10th. And Netflix doesn't have season 3 on instant. And Dom says, yeah, he does, and I think that's in reference to he thinks he fucking swears by that show.
Yeah, well, I downloaded them all, and I erased them already. So.
Oh, you puto. Anyway, yeah, I didn't know what show I was going to get into after 24.
I never got past season one of that show.
Season three fell off a little bit for me. Season five tried to pick it back up. Season six and seven were actually long, and season eight kind of made up for it. It's a good series. Yeah, Oz is in my top 10.
Oh, hey, if you
and Cheap Seats,
Mugwai. While you're
the Quiet Storm.
While you're waiting for the next season of Sons of Anarchy, watch The Shield.
Really?
Yeah,
I think I have that.
I gave it to you, didn't I?
Okay, yeah.
I give you all.
Yeah, yeah. I know. Dom says he can send them to me. All right, Dom.
Oh, there you go.
I will take you up on that offer.
The Shield will wait. Go. I think The Shield will end up in your top 10.
I'm God. Or top, bitch, whatever. Not.
Yeah, like Daybreak was a really good series. You might like Daybreak because
I thought that was a movie with Sylvester Stallone.
No, that's
Daylight or something.
I know what movie you're talking about. Yeah, they're trapped in a tunnel. Maybe that was called Daybreak too.
Incredibly deep and philosophical basis for all Sylvester Stallone movies.
Rocky 3. Oh, hell yeah. That's going to be my next row of sound clips.
Oh, Rocky 3?
It's fucking Apollo Creed and fucking, you know, Clever Lang.
There you go.
Hell yeah. I
love it.
Good idea. I've already got them. Reverend Dom says The Shield is great too, so I guess The Shield will, because a lot of people, like, it was originally going to be 24 and then Lost.
Oh, yeah. Lost, I would say, is not worth your time.
Yeah, I mean, I heard fucking the end gets to a disappointing part.
The end? I would say the first season is the best season, and after that, it just... I sat through everything. I did enjoy it, but here's something, you know, Sons of Anarchy, Entourage, The Shield.
That's what's happening.
What?
You're turning your mic.
Oh, shit, am I?
I'm like, why do you keep going off?
It's been 4 months, man, and I'm not used to this anymore, but... okay, so...
Entourage. Is this chicken what I have, or is
fuck,
this fish?
Fuck, I just did it again. Bumblebee tuna.
I know it's tuna, but it says chicken by the sea.
Man, when I came across that randomly on YouTube, and I've known about it for years, but I was looking for fucking different sound clips on YouTube, and that came up. I'm like, oh my god, I've got to fucking use that for fucking half the stories I get, you know?
Okay, so.
Is this chicken what I have, or is this fish?
Entourage, Sons of Anarchy, The Shield, Dexter... those are all shows.
I have yet to get past episode one of Dexter. It looked really good. I just got away from it.
Yeah. Well, okay. Well, all those shows are shows that I would definitely
Mighty Morphin Power Rangers
watch again. That they have serious replay value. Lost. I endured it once. I'm never gonna watch it again. So I would recommend you stay away from Lost.
Daybreak was a one season shot on ABC. It actually got canceled in the middle of the season. Because, you know, a popular notion is that it had a mixed race relationship in it.
NBC loves to cancel shit.
Fox loves to cancel shit.
Titus.
Titus. I need to get season three from Sal.
Didn't you say there it was coming back?
Yeah, they're actually. It's been confirmed that there's a revival in the works, and it looks possibly to be coming back on Fox, which tells you fucking how much Fox, you know, fucked that one up. And it's supposed to take place after the divorce, after Dad's dead, with the new girlfriend.
Fuck, now Stacey Keach.
That'd be cool if they brought back Stacey Keach on a fucking in the neutral space.
Yeah.
In fact, like, kind of telling them, hey, you should be doing this, you know, wussy. And I fucking crack up. I crack up. Like, I was watching an episode the other night. It was probably like 3:30 in the morning. And Stacey Keach said something, and I fucking belly laughed because I was, you know, I thought it was hilarious. And it's 3:30 in the morning. I'm like, fuck.
Yeah. Check out, go into the archives for the Adam Carolla podcast. Stacey Keach was on there. Fucking brilliant, dude. A good, solid interview for, I think they go for like 2 hours.
Good shit.
Yeah, he's hilarious, and he has a lot of really interesting stories to tell.
But Daybreak is, think a Groundhog Day with a drama interface. It's
with a what?
With a drama tone.
Oh, okay.
Like, this guy...
That sounds terrible.
It's really good. I really dug the series. And I actually have it over there on DVD.
Groundhog's Day? Bill Murray, right?
Bill Murray, yeah.
Yeah, with a dramatic tone.
Yeah, the guy wakes up at the same time on the same day. And, but here's the thing. And you get it's sort of a plot kill for, like, the third episode. Whatever happens to him the day before when he wakes up on the same day, he's still got the same ailment. He actually got shot in an episode, and he woke up with the bullet still in him.
Well.
Yeah, and it's really good. I think you might enjoy it.
Might be worth it.
Yeah. Got it over on DVD if you want to borrow it.
What about Walking Dead?
With Anthony Michael Hall? No, that's...
I don't even know who's on it. The zombie show.
I don't know what you're talking about.
The Walking Dead on AMC. The zombie show.
Never seen it, and I don't have cable anymore. Heard of it? I think I might have heard it. No, I got the DirecTV canceled like a month ago.
EDD is failing you hard, sir.
EDD, you see that box over there?
Okay.
That's the box to send back my receiver for my DirecTV on because I can't afford it anymore.
Jesus Christ. At least you have Xbox, PlayStation.
No, don't get me wrong. Fucking, I got enough shit to fucking keep my mind occupied, and anything I watch, I can find online. So.
Yeah.
So, hey, I'm not really worried about it. In fact, it was the canceling the DirecTV was more of a voluntary sacrifice. Because I was thinking of all the shit I watch. And what I can't watch live. And it's like, oh, well, that's not really fucking... I can't justify spending $120 on it. Because, you know, the last thing I want to do is move. I fucking hate moving. It's not like I don't like a fucking change of scenery. It's I hate the act of moving. I hate fucking having to pack and move.
Fuck this second floor shit, too.
Yeah.
That would suck.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd fucking... Well, you helped me fucking move in the heavy shit.
Did I?
The couches. Yeah.
I don't remember that. Here?
Here.
I just remember, I remember leaving, the old place where you lived with Tony.
Yeah. I remember Gina trying to fucking convince you to take the futon.
Oh, yeah. What the fuck was with that? That was so fucking weird.
Yeah, well.
She was, well, okay. It was kind of like motherly concern. Like, she was offended by the fact that I slept on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the fuck.
Yeah, well.
You sure know how to pick them, though.
No shit. Fuck it. Are we still recording? Hopefully we are. Yeah, we are. Okay. So let's see. Okay, we got rid of the Joe-san story. All right. Tank Abbott and Scott Ferozzo plan a no-holds-barred in Ohio. And I copy the entire story. Joe Show Radio is reporting that David Tank Abbott and Scott Ferozzo have signed for a rematch to be held in an Ohio strip club. Streamed on the internet with pre-unified rules.
This is exactly what the internet should not be used for.
Abbott and Ferozzo first fought at UFC 11 in 1996 with Ferozzo winning the brawl by knockout. And this is actually from the story. Given the stellar state of regulation in Ohio, the likelihood of the bout taking place as described is on the order of an actual Hitler sighting. It's saying fucking it pretty much has no chance of taking place ever.
I'm so disappointed by this story.
Fuck you, asshole.
Michael Bisping says that he deserves next title shot at Anderson Silva, not Chael Sonnen.
Bisping. Name rings a bell.
He's a bloody Englishman, mate.
Ah.
And he's the one who fucking kneed the dude when he was down.
Tall dude, right?
Under this headline, I wrote in brackets, rant on Bisping here. Bisping is claiming that he deserves the next title shot because Chael Sonnen got tapped out, Yushin Okami got beaten, and fucking whatever. Michael Bisping, let's take you back to UFC 100. He got fucking drilled by Dan Henderson, got knocked cold, and fucking Dan Henderson gave him another punch on the way down just to shut him the fuck up. Michael Bisping barely beat Yoshihiro Akiyama. And Michael Bisping fucking damn near got fired for what he did to Jorge Santiago, or Jorge Rivera, or fucking one of those Mexican names. he fucking, the dude's knee was on the ground. He tie clenched him and kneed him right in the face when he was down, and then he went and spit on his corner man. And Michael Bisping
still have a job?
Oh, because they fucking put him in the Ultimate Fighter, and he's going to be fighting Mayhem Miller in November.
Hope he gets his ass kicked.
Yeah. So yeah, fuck Michael Bisping. Complete UFC 136 results. Here we go. Mike Massenzio.
When was this?
This past Saturday. Mike Massenzio defeated Steve Cantwell. Unanimous decision, 29-28 on two scorecards, 30-27 on the other one. Steve Cantwell is a former WEC light heavyweight champion. This is his fourth consecutive loss. More than likely, he's done with the UFC.
Go home and be a family man.
And this was Cantwell's debut at middleweight. And like I said, he was a former... need more sound clips? Go here. Hey, Reverend Dom gave me a website to go download sound clips from. Thank you. Anyway. Stipe Miocic, who the fuck that is, defeated Joey Beltran by unanimous decision, 29-28 twice, 30-27. This was actually Miocic's UFC debut. Joey Beltran is a good fighter. Oh, actually, he's not. Well, he's a decent fighter. He's now 13-6.
Mexican dude from San Diego?
Yeah, I think he fights out of like Escondido or something. Yeah. That's the dude that Pat Barry fucking leg kicked the fuck out of him.
Pat Barry's the shit.
Yeah, Pat Barry is the shit. Pat Barry fucking got another fucking bad loss on his record not too long ago. Anthony Pettis, the former WEC lightweight champion, defeated Jeremy Little Heathen Stevens by split decision, 29-28 on two and 28-29 for Stevens on one. Yeah, Pettis is not exactly, portraying the showtime he's known for. Pettis moves to 12-2, Jeremy Stevens to 20-7. Damian Maia defeated Jorge Santiago by unanimous decision. That was a pretty fucking... It was decisive. It wasn't fucking brutal, but you could tell Damian Maia won that fight. Damian Maia is 15-3. His last loss, I believe, was to Anderson Silva. And that was the fight in Abu Dhabi where fucking Anderson Silva ran away from him like a little bitch. Nam Phan defeated...
Is that guy a champion?
Who?
Silva.
Silva's been champion forever.
Oh, yeah.
Silva's, he's going to be making his fucking... 12th consecutive title defense.
So he's basically going to be champion until he gets too old to
fight. Actually, he's getting there. He's like 37.
Yeah.
Nam Phan defeated Leonard Garcia by unanimous decision, 29-28 on all three scorecards. This was, again, fight of the night. It was not to be not surprising that it was, because their first fight was fight of the night. And this is Leonard Garcia's fifth of the night bonus. This tells you that fucking Leonard Garcia, when he's in the ring, he fucking, he brings it. And they, like, just beat the holy fuck out of each other. It was pretty good. Joe Lozon defeated Melvin Gillard by rear naked choke in 47 seconds.
Sounds like a sex move.
What, the rear naked?
Rear naked choke.
Joe Lozon moves to 21-6. Gillard drops to 29-9-2 and 1-0 contest. Melvin Gillard totally looked past Joe Lozon in this fucking fight. He's like, he pretty much said, made it look like this fight was already over. And Joe Lozon fucking just, punched him, took him down, and like I said, he beat him with a rear naked choke in under a minute. Lozon wins $75,000 for submission of the night. And this is Joe Lozon's sixth consecutive of the night bonus and his seventh overall. Yeah, Joe Lozon does not fucking come to play, and neither, and he doesn't come to work by the hour either. His last three fights have lasted under, a total of under 2 minutes. So,
why isn't he? He should be more of a common name.
Right? He's actually fucking getting back up there. Joe Lozon was a finalist in The Ultimate Fighter a few seasons back. His brother actually won one of The Ultimate Fighters.
Is that still going? Are they still doing those every
year? Oh, yeah. Like, yeah. Here's one thing that I haven't got to cover fucking in the time from Face to Heel. The UFC deal on Fox. Right now, The Ultimate Fighter is taped well months in advance.
Right.
And the finale is live. Okay. Well, beginning in February on FX, The Ultimate Fighter will be live every week. There will be fights every Friday night for fucking the fights in the house, and the whole show will cover what happened in that week in the house.
Sweet.
Yeah.
What is FX? Aren't they like the UPN network?
FX is a Fox network. That's where Sons of Anarchy airs.
Really?
Yes. Sons of Anarchy and The Shield both aired on FX.
Oh, I never
had and cable. Rescue Me, which is also on my list.
I never had cable until a few years ago, yeah. So. I just remember FX being like crappy movie of the week.
FX used to show In Living Color religiously.
No shit.
Hell yeah.
The show was awesome.
Chael Sonnen defeated Brian Stann, which is actually a disappointment to me. I was actually rooting for Brian Stann. I fucking dig both fighters, but I wanted Brian Stann to win this because Brian Stann is Captain America. He beat him by arm.
I remember that guy.
I beat him by arm triangle choke in 3 minutes and 51 seconds of round number 2. This is Sonnen's first fight since he lost to Anderson Silva in August of 2010 and failed a fucking post-fight drug test. Sonnen then got on the microphone and challenged Anderson Silva to a loser-leaves-town fight during Super Bowl weekend. In fact, banter for a minute, I've got to find this.
What the fuck is this, WWF all of a sudden?
Oh my god, it was fucking total WWF style, too.
What the hell? This is a terrible direction for UFC to go.
It is.
What?
I thought it was hilarious, but I'm like, no, don't do this. But Anderson, but Chael Sonnen is a fucking, he's like an asshole on the mic.
Well, you know, I'd be pretty fucking ashamed. And
he also told Anderson Silva that if Anderson Silva doesn't step up his fight game the next time that they fight, that he'll be putting Anderson Silva to sleep permanently and going home and asking Anderson Silva's wife to make a mistake.
That is bad sportsmanship right there.
Oh, Chael Sonnen is fucking... He tries to... here it is.
Well, I'd be pissed if I lost to that high voice talking dude, too.
This isn't a fight that's going to be tit for tat.
This isn't a war. We're not going to go out and battle each other.
This is going to be a one-sided pounding, and I'm swinging the hammer.
Actually, like, this isn't it. Fucking where is it at? Actually, Edgar Maynard 3, here it is. I just gotta find it.
This dude's been injecting too much testosterone. I think that's what's happening.
That's what here. He got popped for.
Yeah. Well, he's talking shit, and he's probably gonna get his ass.
Actually, let me start at the beginning. It's only a few seconds in.
This isn't a fight that's gonna be tit for tat.
This isn't a war. We're not gonna go out and battle each other.
This is gonna be a one-sided pounding, and I'm swinging the hammer.
Anderson Silva is easily the most unpopular fighter in this company.
There's this dirtbag named Anderson Silva.
When Anderson Silva walks into a room, you could hear a rat piss on cotton.
The fuck does that even mean?
I love Chael Sonnen on the mic.
About the time that Ed Soros, the Nogueira brothers, and Anderson all walked into a bar, but there was only one stool left, right? So they just turned it upside down? You heard that?
Anderson Silva... You absolutely suck.
This is what happened after UFC 136.
Holy shit, it's Daniel Dasher.
Super Bowl weekend, the biggest rematch in the history of the business. I'm calling you out, Silva, but we're up in the stakes. Beat you. You leave the division. You beat me. I will leave the UFC forever.
not crazy. I get it that he's a good, skilled guy. At the same time, he's a chicken, he's a coward, and he won't fight me.
Why you always say bad things about our people and especially about our country?
Oh, yeah, and by the way, Anderson or fucking Chael Sonnen talks massive shit about fucking Brazil and Brazilians.
Because I am attempting to pick a fight with some Brazilian fighters. Not fighters that care about you, Brazil. Fighters who have abandoned you. Fighters that claim they're from Brazil, like Vanderlei Silva, but he lives in a gated community in Las Vegas. He drives an Aston Martin. Do you guys even know what that is? That's what James Bond drove. It cost $200,000. Vanderlei could have bought a fully loaded Lexus, drove around in style for $41,000, sent $159,000 back to your country, built two schools, but he didn't. He didn't send you $159,000. He didn't send you $159. He didn't send you 159 cents. He left you, abandoned you, and now he lives in America. Anderson loves to claim Brazil. He just put $2 million down on a high-rent mansion in Los Angeles. I apologize to the Brazilian people that your heroes left you.
That is alcohol testosterone talk, sir.
I love him. I love Chael Sonnen on the mic.
Oh, makes for good TV, but I'm watching that video just looking for Vince McMahon to pop out.
Exactly.
Somewhere.
And you know what? As a person who fucking digs both professional wrestling and mixed martial arts, I don't do that.
No, let's not blur that line. That line is there for a reason.
In unrelated news, UFC fighter Brock Lesnar will be in the new WWE 12 game.
What?
Yep. Dana White, actually, Dana White and Vince McMahon are really good. As in, like, they're, like, they're fucking, like, tight.
Well, yeah. That kind of makes sense, actually.
Yeah, because fucking, no matter what UFC can do, Vince McMahon knows how to do pay-per-view.
Oh, yeah.
And Vince McMahon fucking obviously talks pay-per-view with Dana White.
Yeah.
That and Dana White's homeboys. Yeah, Dana White is fucking actually friends with a lot of fucking high, you know, talent in the WWE. He gives The Undertaker 3 fucking major tickets to every show that they have. Because Undertaker's a huge MMA buff.
That could be pretty beneficial. I mean, you can take a lot of fighters that are past their prime in UFC, but they can still have an effect, in the WWE.
Oh, absolutely.
Universe. So it gives UFC fighters a place to retire too. No health benefits.
Yeah, unlike the UFC, which fucking fully covers their shit. Let's see who is.
So
there.
WWE is like the glue factory.
Still
for
got
horses.
Two listeners. And one is, still got the Salt Lake City listener. Hey, Salt Lake City. A fucking woo.
What's in Salt Lake City other than the only thing
Mormons, I know, a lake.
How's that movie, that 90s movie, SLC Punk?
I think I've seen that.
That's the only frame of reference I have. Heroin addicts and punk rockers.
Yeah. But let's bring this back up. Yeah, so, yeah, you heard Chael Sonnen challenging Anderson Silva to a Loser Leaves Town fight during Super Bowl weekend. And this is Brian Stann's first loss at 185 pounds. Chael Sonnen improves to 26-11-1. Brian Stann drops to 11-4.
Jose Aldo.
Jose Aldo defeated Kenny Florian by unanimous decision 49-46 across all the scorecards to retain his UFC featherweight championship.
This is still not Brazil.
Aldo's fourth consecutive title defense, his third UFC, and he actually defended his WEC title once. I'm still trying to figure out why Kenny Florian deserved this title fight. Kenny Florian is now 0-3 in title matches. He fought Sean Sherk and BJ Penn both at 155 pounds. Now,
did he beat BJ Penn?
No, BJ Penn put the fucking hurt on him.
That's what I figured.
No, here's the thing. Kenny Florian was in the finals of the Ultimate Fighter Season 1 as a 185-pound fighter. He lost to Diego Sanchez. He tried 185, didn't work. He tried 170, didn't work. He tried 155, didn't work twice.
That's a one-trick pony, then.
He tried 145. Now, here's the thing. Kenny Florian fought one fight at 145 pounds, won it, and got a title shot. Chad Money Mendes is 11-0 in that same division and did not get that next title shot.
fucking politics, man. There's no set standard for how deals work in the UFC, right?
Fuck UFC. Not fuck UFC, but fuck Kenny Florian. Because he's like, oh, blah, 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 blah. I'm going to be the master of this division. And Kenny Florian is the first fighter to compete in four different weight divisions in the UFC.
And lose all of them.
And lose. Like, he won a majority of his fights. He's 14-6. But he lost the three title fights. And here's the thing. I'm like, okay, well, is Kenny Florian going to try and drop down to 135 pounds now or maybe even 125 pounds, you know, to actually get a title? He just can't do it when it fucking counts. He's the Clay Guida. He's the Chris Jericho. The WCW Chris Jericho.
Oh.
Of UFC.
Low blow, sir.
I dig the fucking. I'm a huge Jerichoholic.
I don't even like him.
It's midnight.
Still a low blow.
It's midnight on October 15th now. So happy Saturday.
Are we going till when?
We're going till we finish.
Three?
No, we won't be going till three. We're already 2 hours in. So.
Oh shit! Really?
Yeah. Frankie Edgar defeated Gray Maynard in the fourth round at a 354 by TKO. To retain his UFC lightweight championship. These two, I believe you were at this fight with us, on New Year's Day, fought for the title and ended up going to a 5-round draw.
I went to that?
I think you were there. I don't know.
When?
New Year's Day.
Yeah, but...
January 1st.
This past one?
No. Though on the one, January 1st. These two fought on January 1st to a 5-round draw. They fought again this past Saturday. And in that first fight this would have been the third fight. In the second fight on January 1st, Frankie Edgar got his ass beat in the first round, but came back fucking to win at least three of the four remaining rounds, and that's how it went to a 5-round draw. Well, guess what? Frankie Edgar got his face bashed in the first round and came back again, but this time fucking knocked out Gray Maynard in the fourth. Needless to say, this was knockout of the night because of the fucking brutal way he put him down.
Have I seen this fight?
No, this was this past Saturday.
Okay. Did you save it? Or?
I haven't got it yet because my fucking news groups and, yeah.
Right.
It'll be there on the 25th.
Right on.
Anyway, Frankie Edgar improves to 14-1-1, and the one loss and the one draw are both to Gray Maynard. And Gray Maynard suffers his first loss. He goes to 10-1-1-1 no contest. And let's see. That's the end of the UFC 136 results. Gilbert Melendez will be defending his Strikeforce 155-pound title against Jorge Masvidal in December, which happens to be in San Diego. Dana White was talking about bringing over Gilbert Melendez to the UFC immediately, but Gilbert Melendez still has a title defense left on his contract.
Do they still merge that thing yet?
Here's the thing.
They're just still doing that?
Here's the thing. Gilbert Melendez is the Strikeforce 155-pound champion. There were never 135 or 145-pound champions in Strikeforce. The 170-pound champion, Nick Diaz, vacated his title to come to the UFC.
Right.
Okay. And it, for a title shot, which he didn't get.
But why are they still acting as if it's separate when they're trying to...
They have a Showtime contract.
So they have to run out their contract first?
Exactly.
How long is the contract?
It expires in February.
So after that, they can unify both leagues?
Unless they re-sign a contract with Showtime.
So to speak.
Right. Now, here's the thing. The 185-pound champion is Luke Rockhold. But Luke Rockhold was scheduled to defend his title against Tim Kennedy. Tim Kennedy signed a UFC contract yesterday. So, obviously, there goes that match.
What clusterfuck.
Strikeforce 205-pound champion, Dan Henderson, re-signed with the UFC. So, that title's vacant. And the Strikeforce heavyweight champion, Alistair Overeem, was cut and then signed the UFC. So, that title's vacant.
He's fighting Brock, right?
He's fighting Brock on December 30th.
Yeah. So, Strikeforce is going to be the janitors against the ushers?
Yeah, pretty much. And the women.
Oh, they have a women's league?
Yeah, they have two women's champions.
UFC doesn't, right?
UFC does not, and I don't believe Dana White will be bringing them over because Dana White doesn't fucking dig women's fighting.
You're all fired.
But, yeah. Gilbert Melendez will be defending his title in Strikeforce in December in San Diego. Dana White says Nick Diaz is back in title contention with a win over BJ Penn. I don't know if you read this or not, but actually, you were at the last event. Nick Diaz was supposed to came over from Strikeforce, came over to the UFC to fight George St. Pierre for his welterweight title. Nick Diaz no-showed his pressers. Dana White says, fuck you, and gave his title shot to Carlos Condit. And as punishment, he put Nick Diaz against BJ Penn.
Why is that punishment?
Because I don't think fucking BJ, I don't think BJ Penn's gonna, you know, gonna be that easy for Nick Diaz. Like, Dana White is known for punishing his fighters when they fucking, when they do something to
so,
fuck him
so
up.
So he's setting him up to get his ass beat.
Pretty much. Like, he set up Randy Couture. Randy Couture was the UFC heavyweight champion, and then he left for a contract dispute. Left with the title, and held that title for over a year because they actually UFC sued him for breach of contract. Well, Randy Couture comes back to the UFC, and guess who they put him against? Brock Lesnar.
Was that
that was punishment.
That was Brock Lesnar's like that early
was,
fight.
That was Brock Lesnar's third overall or fourth overall MMA fight, and his and he got a title shot. I am a huge fan of Brock Lesnar. Brock Lesnar did not earn that title shot. That was punishment for Randy Couture.
Yeah, punishment and politics.
Yeah, fucking. Oh yeah, you want to fuck with us like that? Cool. We'll put you against the biggest guy in the division. And he did the like he did the same thing with Tito Ortiz. Fucking yeah, you know. Oh, you want to have beef with me? Oh, okay, you know what? Guess what? Cool. We got our business practices underway, and you know we're cool again. But I'm putting you against Lyoto Machida, the best guy in the division. That's what he did to Tito Ortiz.
Oh, Tito Ortiz got his ass kicked recently, right?
Tito Ortiz got his fucking damn near got his chest caved in by Rashad Evans.
But he won the first fight when he was making his comeback.
Yeah, he beat Ryan Bader, which was an absolute disappointment.
Yeah, I saw that one. I didn't see the one where he got his ass kicked.
Oh yeah, fucking he took. But you know what? That fight gave me a lot more respect for Tito Ortiz because he took that fucking ass beating like a man. And he took that fight with only 2 weeks' notice.
It was how many rounds?
It was the two round. Yeah. Speaking of Rashad Evans,
knockout.
Speaking of Rashad Evans, guess what? Rashad Evans, remember fucking John Jones? And he's like, I'm gonna be fighting. Nope.
Wasn't his arm broken or something?
His fucking he had just had pins removed from his hand. So John Jones will be defending his UFC 205 title in November against Lyoto Machida.
That dude's 205.
Yeah.
Fucking does not look it.
But yeah.
Well, my money's on him.
Yeah. Who, Jones?
Jones,
oh,
for
yeah.
sure.
Hell yeah. Dana White says this about Nick Diaz. Quote, I don't see Diaz skipping a press conference happening again. He knows we've talked. Seriously, I would be shocked if he didn't show up to another press conference. And if he does, I don't even know what to say. I guess that would just be the end of it. He doesn't have to answer one question if he doesn't want to. I just want him to sit there, then get up, then do the face-off. I don't want him to be. I don't want him to not be Nick Diaz. I just need him to show up to stuff like that. And Nick Diaz hates fucking press conferences. But guess what? So does George St. Pierre. And GSP actually said at a press conference, I dislike these things, but I do it because it's part of the job. You're supposed to fucking promote your own fight.
Dana White's like a king over here.
In pro wrestling news, WWE is sucking again after they had a nice little 3-week run there. TNA still sucks. And for all you old schoolers, go to justin.tv/the_str02. And it's the Stro. I believe they're on 1989 right now. They play every fucking weekly and every pay-per-view from 1987 to 2001. And they end at WrestleMania 17, and then it goes into Request Week. And Request Week is fucking hilarious, because, you know, you can request anything that has anything to do with wrestling. So, like it went WrestleMania 17, WrestleMania 19, the movie No Holds Barred, an old NWA show, the movie They Live.
So did you request David Arquette?
No, Ready to Rumble was already on the list, and I watched it.
What? Why?
I figured it was time to watch it. I've never seen Ready to Rumble.
A piece of my heart died right now, sir. What is this?
Have you seen Ready to Rumble?
Yeah.
As a hardcore wrestling fan, it wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. But it's also a movie I never need to watch again.
You're getting old, sir. You're
fuck
getting,
you.
You're getting complacent in your old age.
Complacent.
What is this
fuck
faggotry?
Fuck you, asshole. Fuck you, asshole.
I never thought I'd see the day when you watched that fucking movie.
Well, I didn't fucking order it. It just came up on the stream.
Fucking.
I'm God, and bitch you not.
Oh, man, I'm gonna need to take a moment to process this new information.
You know what? Well, you can't have your moment because during break, you actually came up with an idea.
Oh, did I?
Yes, you did. You actually came up with an idea. Surprising.
Enlighten me.
You said, hey, when we come back, why don't we do a thing where I ask you blah, blah, blah.
Oh, okay.
So go ahead.
I'm not going to interview, am I?
No.
No. Oh, just...
He forgot his own fucking idea.
I forgot my own sheer brilliance. That's how it happens in geniuses.
And he got mad. He found it slightly offensive that I said he was a deep thinker.
That's silly.
You're like the guy on the statue.
The thinker.
The thinker.
Okay. Oh, so the question was, let me see if I can elaborate this properly. So podcasting is a fairly popular thing. It certainly is available to anyone who wants it. You don't even need the fancy equipment that you have.
Nope.
All you need is an internet connection and a mic. But on the negative side, there's way too much fucking information on the internet. There's such an overwhelming amount that the likelihood that anyone's ever going to see your stuff is super low. I mean, even your Twitter, your Facebook. I mean, your Facebook is mostly your friends, right? But Twitter, I mean, who the fuck looks at your Twitter and keeps up with it?
Exactly.
So having said that, there's a chance, it's very likely that, you know, no one's going to listen to this podcast.
Right.
So, tonight we had 3 listeners. That's fucking awesome. That's
over 300% more than I was expecting.
So anyway, the point is, what's the point of it? Why are you doing it if there's little chance for actual communication or actual connection with other people?
Mainly for me. And here's why. I've always been a person who didn't have stage fright. And if no one hears this except for me 5 years down the road, then guess what? I've got something to remember it by. That's the same reason why I used to always carry a video camera. I did it for me because my memory is not what it used to be, but remembering these things and seeing how they are, that's why I'm recording this instead of just a stream, because it's just a stream. It's like, fucking, hey, we've wasted our time. No, I mainly do this for me because, you know, I've always been into, you know, just putting it out there. I've got old tapes, which no one will ever fucking listen to, ever, of me pretending to be a DJ playing music on Q106. Okay? No one will ever hear those tapes, because I was like 9 when I made them. And I'm embarrassed when I listened to them like 5 years ago. I was embarrassed on how stupid I sounded. I've never really had stage fright. I've kind of always wanted to be the person who fucking just put it out there, which is why fucking I'd love to go to school for broadcasting. And, you know, if no one hears this, okay. I've got fucking archive footage that's like, hey, fucking, you know, that kind of sounded good. Kind of the same thing with the backyard wrestling when I did it. No one was ever going to see it, although we got YouTube now, so a lot of people can see it.
I've seen them, that's for sure.
But it's like, it's, you know, I've got something that, you know, I'm kind of living a fantasy, so to speak, but I've also got something that I can go back and listen to or see or do again. And it's much better than what I've been doing lately, which is nothing. Thank you to the California State Employment Development Department.
Whole lot of nothing.
Fuck you, Sony. But yeah, I mean, I don't do it to try and be famous. I don't try and do it to try and garner fucking, you know, unwarranted attention, although I'll plug this thing.
Just if the attention comes, you'll take it.
But, you know, I'm not every local band who fucking thinks they're gonna be the next, you know, Guns N' Roses or whatever. Okay, I had to date myself. I couldn't fucking say the next, like, you know, Tupac or the next, you know, the next U2 or Coldplay.
Well, look at Guns N' Roses now. I don't think anyone wants to be the next Guns N' Roses.
The next 1980s Guns N' Roses. How about that? There but, you go. I don't do it. I don't do it for any other purpose than just to do it. It's killing almost 2.5 hours on a Friday night. And yes, this tells you what kind of fucking life I live. I'm home recording something that three people at one time listen to. Three people.
Are we down to one now?
We're probably down to one. I think we still got two. We got the random person from Salt Lake City, and actually, you know what? Let me check that real quick. Do we still? How many people do we have still? Load up. We got two listeners. We had a maximum of five.
Wow, that's way better than expected.
Yeah. So, and the two listeners are fucking the random person from Salt Lake City and Reverend Dom.
Oh, Dom's still with us?
Yeah. I'm pretty sure Dom's still with us.
Look at that dedication. That's, what time is it over there?
It's 3:15 in the morning.
It's amazing.
And Reverend Dom's going to plug it on the Lurch and Dom Live broadcast.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you just said it.
Wow.
Nice.
Thank you, Reverend
Dom.
Thank
you, Reverend Dom.
Fucking awesome.
But yeah, so, yeah, were there anything else leading, you know, from that? Oh, and that, and I also use it as a distraction.
No, I think I was just going to ask you, and you were going to ask me, and that's it.
Oh, yeah, I, you know, this is like, the more distraction I have from everything that's going on, and in more important terms, everything that's not going on, the more distractions I have, the better. And this is a distraction that Reverend Dom says I still have more listeners than he does for the gospel.
No way, I don't believe that.
I don't believe it either. Although I think we are a good chunk of his listeners.
Yeah, probably.
Sorry, Dom. I'll take the blame for that one. but yeah, I mean, it's fun for me at least.
Yeah.
For Primo, he has to fucking. And what took you so long to get here?
Oh shit!
Here we go. Here's another story. Did you take the 163?
No, I took the 94.
Did you hear about the dude on the University Bridge in downtown? Fucking, yeah, 163 came to a fucking stop.
What was he doing, taking shots at people?
No, he was fucking threatening to jump.
I should have just let him jump and get on with it.
That's what people were saying. But, yeah, like...
Really? No, I didn't hear about that.
Oh, yeah, I was fucking... I had a few people tell me about that one. Jill was one of them.
No, actually,
Warm-ass water.
Right before I came here, I had a meeting with Fabian talking about our next film project, because I'll be walking TJ. And that was out in, I guess it's Sotay, or it's like, you know, Plaza de las Americas?
Yeah.
Yeah, we were out there at the Starbucks.
Oh, okay. Did you go by the Sony Style store and tell them to go fuck themselves?
Hell no. I didn't even know the Sony Style was there.
Yeah.
Well, if it was there, I would have gone and taken a shit on their front door. But I didn't know it was there. So, yeah, so I came out, and I actually missed the junction to, I think it's the 54, or the coming back on the 5. The 54. Okay. The 54, yeah. So I ended up in downtown somewhere. I caught the 94.
So you were in South Bay when you texted me up.
Yeah.
See, I'm sitting there thinking you were at home, and, like, I looked at the clock because you texted me at 9:04.
Yeah.
I looked at the clock and said 9:30. So fucking Primo must be driving the speed limit. Yeah. It doesn't take 26 minutes for me to drive from his house.
I probably should have mentioned that was out. You know.
Oh, no problem. That's why I'm sitting there now. It's like all of a sudden the time's ticking away, tick, tick, tick. And that's why I like threw on some old school music. Like I'm, you know, throwing things up, and I threw on a song, you know, threw on a few songs that Dom liked, and I threw on a couple of other old things. And at first it was nothing but Puro Cachanilla from Abuelito. I put that on loop, and I'm like, all right, let's change this up. Actually, I think I might have that go on the outro, and we'll record it.
All right.
But, yeah.
So. Yeah, well, I came over on the 94, and I've never I've gotten home on the 94, but I've never come this way to the 94.
Yeah.
So I got lost, and I ended up pulling over and using the GPS, which I should have done in the first fucking place, but.
Yeah. Well, Primo's got nothing else for me. I don't think I have anything for him. We kind of covered it all, I think. Oh, okay. So, yeah. So, Primo, I obviously gave an explanation on why I'm doing this. Why are you doing this? Oh, and you know what? I thought that even if no one did it, if you ever wanted to fucking put your music out there, if we even had one listener or three or five, we could fucking plug something.
Give you a copy.
Yeah.
And play our music.
Right.
It's a good idea.
Yeah. Even if we have, you know, zero listeners and no one, you know, no one gives a shit about us. And
I would say I have two reasons for doing it. One is pretty much the opposite of yours, or where you've always been the type of person that'll put it out there and no stage fright. I was pretty shy growing up, and
yeah, for that, let's go. You know, we can go back to the first episode of From Face to Heel that Primo ever did, and I told him leading into it. I said, you know what? Once you do it, you'll probably start to like it.
Yeah, exactly. I definitely like it now. But yeah, it's definitely something that I've had to get over. I mean, I've done a show with my band, so that helped a lot. And doing this, we did it regularly for a while with From Face to Heel. It definitely helps. It's fun. And once you do something like this, it makes it easier to do other things. So that's one reason. The other reason is just to keep the creative juices flowing. I'm a pretty creative person. I do a lot of drawing, a lot of painting. I'm working on a film project, two film projects, still making music. So doing this is kind of a way to get momentum and get just, like I said, get the creative juices flowing and just have fun, I guess.
And that brought up, another reason why I do this. When we used to do From Face to Heel for fucking 3 hours, which I didn't think this was going to be a 3-hour show, but apparently it's getting to that. It gave me a chance to speak and just, you know, I mean, I can put whatever thoughts I can have into writing, but when you just bleh, whatever's on your mind, be it, you know, fucking what you think about wrestling or MMA or fucking DMT or whatever the fucking, and I have every episode we ever did. I downloaded those.
Oh shit!
Yeah,
I'm gonna need those.
Yeah,
Do you have Dropbox?
I do have Dropbox.
Oh, you don't put them in there. I'll send you an invite, and so I can just get them that way.
Okay. Cool. Yeah, Dropbox is great.
Brilliant.
Yeah. I got Dropbox because I have an Android, and fucking the Android app for it's great. So like any picture I take, fucking send to Dropbox. Boom, send this computer. Anyway. Nice. But yeah, I mean, because I find that if I'm not, if I don't yap it out, then, even though I can put it into writing, there's some part of me that feels like I needed to get something out. Like, when we, our fucking two trips to Rudford's.
Oh, yeah.
Where you got a chicken fried pork chop.
That waitress was stupid.
The waitress was fucking hella stupid. it's like, okay, me and the Primo here, we've, for past 4 years, we've made trips to fucking restaurants and Mexican food shops and talked about nothing and talked about fucking important issues, at least to me. And it helped. Even though that this is not talking about anything, that would seem helpful, it's just like my blogging. It's therapeutical. It helps me fucking, I project, therefore I release something, even though it might have nothing to do with, what's really going on. It fucking, it's like a stress reliever. And I don't have a cat, so. Or fucking, or Primo's cool dog Vader.
It's a pretty cool dog.
The dog is cool. And, hey, fucking Dom's got Dropbox too.
Oh, no shit.
All right, cool.
Awesome.
But yeah, so that, and just to clarify, all right, I was actually, the whole live feed thing, very spur of the moment. And like I told Primo, I like the live feed because it brings a whole new element to it. Now, Primo just happened to say Friday night. And is it my intention to compete with Big Bar or the Round Table? Absolutely not. They have their thing. Their slogan is all the time. My slogan is one show a week. Maybe two. We'll find, it's all a matter of, Primo says, hey, I'm coming over. Let's do a podcast tonight. All right.
Cool. The deal is there's a Dive Bomber show tonight, and I was going to go to it if you were going to it.
And I did not go to it because, I'm broke.
So,
yeah. And it's in Garden Grove.
In Garden Grove. I don't even know how far away is that.
Garden Grove's up by Huntington Beach. It's about fucking 110 miles.
Yeah. That's a stay home on Friday night, yeah, kind of thing. So that's why it was this Friday.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, hey, whatever, you know. But yeah. When's October the 29th? That's two Saturdays from now. I still got to find out if we're doing the Ramona show. Because if we're not, I'll go with you to TJ. I'll watch the Condit fight after.
Yeah, you can you record it? Or?
Yeah, I can record it or download it.
Okay.
But, yeah. Did you have anything more on that? Get creative juices flowing? Fucking.
No, I think that's it. Yeah, it's one of the many things, many creative things I do. So this one is definitely the most stress-free. everything else, you know, there's a pressure to come up with ideas and to create.
And it's really nice to not have a format or a start time. Although, like, since we're doing it live, you know, we can kind of, you know, put there, like, hey, we'll try and start around this time.
We should be cool to Dom because he's fucking, he's 3 hours ahead.
Hell yeah. Dom, it's 3:30 in the fucking morning there. And actually, like, Dom's like, can you listen to it on the phone? I spent like 2 hours trying to figure out a way. I was like, oh, let me see if I can do it. And I actually tried getting it to where we'd be public fucking listed on Shoutcast. And apparently fucking I need to configure something else. But hey, whatever.
Probably have to pay, don't you?
Well, you gotta like broadcast through a server and then let the server see your computer. I'm behind a 3-point router. And fucking apparently it wasn't seeing my computer, so I'm like, okay, fuck it. Forget being public. I'll fucking, you know.
What category would you put it under? Anyway?
Miscellaneous.
Miscellaneous.
Yeah.
No bullshit category.
Create your own category. Fucking someone's looking, hey, what's this bullshit category?
Bullshit. Utter nonsense category.
Fucking cochina, what? But, yeah, so, yeah, I think that's all I got.
I'm with you. I got nothing.
All right. Well, we appreciate anyone who's listened to the live feed, and we especially appreciate anyone who will be listening to this in podcast form. This is the end of episode one of the Rusty Razor podcast. My name is Designated Dave.
Primo.
And this is Abuelito going to lead you out. Some puro cachanilla. We'll see you fucking. Well, when you see you. Go ahead. Look like you. No? No?
No.
Okay.
Nothing.
Nací en los algodonales bajo un sol abrasador. Mis manos se encallecieron y me bañé de sudor. Yo soy puro cachanilla, orgulloso y cumplidor. Mexicali fue mi cuna, Tecate mi adoración. De mi coqueta Tijuana traigo prendido un amor, y por allá en Ensenada se quedó mi corazón. El cerro de Centinela, altivo y viejo guardián, tiene un lugar en la historia de esta mi tierra natal. Yo soy puro cachanilla, lo digo sin pretensión, soy de Baja California, norteño de corazón. Y arriba por su valle tan querido, mil veces me fui.
Bringing our lives mics back on live, because this is worth it. Let me see if anyone's still listening. This is actually still being recorded for the podcast, so even if you're not listening, you'll hear it on the end of the podcast. Where's it at? We got two listeners still. And it's the same two listeners. All right.
Someone's idling, probably.
Okay, my cousin, my mom's cousin, is a friend of mine on the Facebook. And under the whole, I linked the site to the stream.
Yeah.
And my cousin says, my iPhone won't allow me to listen. Is there something I can do? And I says, get something different than an iPhone.
Get a droid.
Get a droid. Or even a BlackBerry, because it'll work too.
BlackBerry's dying, aren't they?
Oh, fuck yeah, dude. Did you have the outage that they fucking talked about the other day?
No, I didn't have the outage.
Yeah, but fucking BlackBerry, like, fucking their system.
As far as their marketing and their whole, bringing out new phones and everything.
And check, and you know what? I would definitely like to get the playbook, though, if it wasn't so fucking expensive.
What price are we talking?
It's like $500, but it's a BlackBerry fucking tablet that also runs Android apps.
How big is this tablet?
I don't know. I think it might be 10 inches. Stop it.
It's not bad. That's doable. Hell.
Back to abuelito.
Estación Victoria, cuervos y mi mezquital, su gran colonia Carranza, San Felipe y Cucapá. Mi tierra es una esmeralda, siempre bañada de sol. Desde el alta rumorosa les brindo yo mi canción. A su laguna salada y a todita mi región. El cerro del centinela, altivo y viejo guardián, tiene un lugar en la historia de esta mi tierra natal. Yo soy puro cachanilla, lo digo sin pretensión, soy de Baja California.